레벨은 다르다 어나더 레벨 하식스와 함께하는 ASL 시즌 14 24강 B조 경기로 함께합니다. 안녕하세요, 이영경입니다. 어제 24강 A조 개막전 경기에서는 도제국 변현재 이 두 프로토스 선수가 살아남아 16강으로 향했는데요. 단판전의 짜릿함을 여과 없이 느껴볼 수 있는 어제 경기였습니다. 저 오늘은 B조 경기를 여러분들은 만나보실 수 있습니다. B조 경기를 앞두고 있는 선수들 만나서 이야기 나눠보겠습니다. 안녕하세요.
안녕하세요.
네, 조일장 김경모, 황경영, 김윤중 선수입니다. 자, 먼저 조일장 선수와 이야기 나눠보겠습니다. 안녕하세요.
안녕하세요.
자, 시즌 12와 13을 시드를 가지고 시작하셨기 때문에 이번 시즌 14 예선이 굉장히 오랜만이셨겠더라고요.
네.
거의 1년 만에 예선을 치르셨는데 좀 어떠셨나요?
아, 일단 예선은 역시 쉽지 않다는 생각이 들더라고요. 이게 아침에 일어나서 게임을 해야 되다 보니까 약간 컨디션 좋지 않았는데 그래도 한 번에 뚫어가지고 그래도 괜찮았던 것 같아요.
이번 시즌 시드에 대한 간절함이 조금 더 커지셨을 것 같아요. 예선을 거치면서 지난 시즌을 좀 돌이켜보면 조금 다소 빠르게 탈락한 감이 없지 않아 있어서 아쉬운 마음도 굉장히 크셨을 것 같은데 그만큼 또 지난 시즌이 좋은 약이 되시지 않았을까요?
일단 지난 시즌을 돌이켜보면은 뭔가 좀 긴장을 좀 많이 했던 것 같아요. 좀 부담을 많이 느꼈는지 그랬던 것 같아서 이번 시즌은 그냥 마음 편하게 그냥 하던 대로 할까 합니다.
근데 오늘 또 첫 경기가 공교롭게도 저저전이거든요. 마음 편히 하기에는 단판전의 저저전. 사실 마음 편하게 하기 쉽지는 않을 것 같아요.
이게 1차전이 또 공교롭게 저저전이더라고요. 좀 단판 저저전 좀 싫어하긴 하는데 그래도 이겨야죠. 네.
김경모 선수가 바로 그 상대입니다. 이야기를 좀 나눠볼게요. 안녕하세요.
네, 안녕하세요.
지난 시즌 김경모 선수의 활약상이 워낙 대단했습니다. 예선부터 또 이번 시즌은 엄청난 결과를 가지고 돌아오셨더라고요. 결승에서 김민철 선수를 상대로 2-1 승리를 거두고 돌아오셨는데 예선의 경기들을 조금 돌이켜보면 그 결과에 대해서 어느 정도 좀 예상을 하셨을까요?
이제 좀 나이가 드니까 테란전이랑 토스전 좀 힘들더라고요. 그래서 믿을 게 이제 저저전밖에 없는데 그냥 제주 좋게 이제 저저전만 걸려가지고 예선 뚫은 것 같아요.
또 첫 경기가 조일장 선수와 저저전을 펼치게 돼서 아마 김경모 선수 조금 자신감을 가지고 오셨을 것 같은데 경기 앞두고 계신 지금의 컨디션은 어떠세요?
일찍 와가지고 손 푸니까 오늘 마우스 좀 감이 좀 좋아가지고 잘 될 것 같아요.
지난 시즌엔 또 장윤철 선수를 꺾고 많은 분들을 좀 놀라게 했던 결과를 김경모 선수가 만들어내셨기 때문에 이번 시즌도 그런 결과를 많은 분들이 좀 기대를 하고 계실 것 같거든요. 본인의 생각은 어떠신가요?
아, 그때는 윤철이가 좀 방심 많이 했던 것 같은데 이번에는 상대들이 방심할 선수들은 아닌 것 같아가지고 좀 힘들 것 같긴 한데 이제 뭐 준비 잘 해왔으니까 잘할 생각입니다.
준비를 완벽하게 해왔다는 김경모 선수의 경기도 굉장히 궁금해지는데요. 옆에 계신 황병영 선수와도 이야기 나눠보겠습니다. 안녕하세요.
네, 안녕하세요.
황병영 선수는 2년 전 ASL 시즌 9을 시작으로 벌써 6회째 계속해서 본선 함께하고 계세요. 약간 꾸준함의 상징처럼 되어가고 계신 것 같은데요. 이번 시즌도 함께하게 되신 소감은 어떠신가요?
저는 늘 그렇듯 약간 계속 성장 중이라고 생각을 해서 이번 시즌도 그래도 제가 폼이 제일 좋지 않나 그래서 좀 자신 있게 할 수 있을 것 같아요.
아무래도 그런데 B조에서는 황병영 선수가 유일하게 좀 대학에 소속되어 있지 않은 선수여서 준비 과정이 녹록지는 않으셨을 것 같아요.
그래도 진짜 많이 도와줬어요. 진짜 다 바쁜데도 부탁하니까 다 그래도 도와줘가지고 연습은 충분히 할 수 있었던 것 같아요.
연습도 충분하고 자신감도 충분한 황병영 선수도 한번 기대해 보도록 하겠습니다. 계속해서 이 자리에 아쉽게 함께 하시지는 못하지만 역시 B조 경기를 준비하고 있는 선수 김윤중 선수와도 인사를 좀 나눠보겠습니다. 김윤중 선수 안녕하세요.
네, 안녕하세요.
아, 경기장에서 함께 할 수 있었으면 너무 좋았을 텐데 아쉽습니다. 많은 분들이 김윤중 선수의 컨디션 무엇보다 많이 걱정하고 계실 것 같아요. 좀 어떠신가요?
솔직히 말하면 막 엄청 좋진 않고요. 그래도 상대가 너무 쉬워서 상대들이 컨디션이랑 상관없을 것 같습니다.
상대들이 쉽다. 가장 쉬운 상대 비주에서 어떤 선수라고 좀 생각하고 계신가요? 김윤중 선수.
아까 뭐 손놀림이 오늘 좋다고 한 깨모 선수? 네, 제일 쉬운 상대가 아닌가.
김경호 선수 정말 경기장 일찍 와서 손 많이 풀었거든요. 김윤중 선수. 무섭지 않으세요?
손 많이 풀어봤자 깨모죠. 네.
아, 또 같은 대학에서 활동하고 있는 조일장 선수도 경우의 수에 따라 또 만날 수가 있습니다. 김경모 선수 같은 적은데 김윤중 선수, 조일장 선수의 경기는 어떻게 좀 예상하실까요?
우선은 저희 목표는 또 같은 대학이기도 하고 둘이 같이 올라가는 게 목표이기 때문에 1장이랑 저랑 이제 1장이 뭐 솔직히 잘하잖아요. 1등으로 올려보내고 제가 2등으로 올라가겠습니다.
아, 김윤중 선수의 답변을 들으니까 현장에 함께하고 있는 듯한 현장감이 좀 느껴지는 것 같습니다. 이번에는 또 팬분들이 전해주신 질문을 선수들께 드려보겠습니다. 먼저 조일장 선수, 김경모 선수에 대한 질문인데요. 조일장 선수가 정말 힘겹게 예선을 올라왔던 시즌이 있습니다. 바로 시즌 11. 예선에서 만났던 상대가 바로 김경모 선수였습니다. 당시 김경모 선수가 2대0으로 승리를 거뒀어요.
네.
그때에 대한 기억이 조일장 선수의 머릿속에 남아있을까요?
그날 경기는 잘 기억이 안 나고 그날 제가 열이 40도였던 것만 기억나가지고
아...
네. 오늘은 별 문제 없을 것 같아요.
아, 근데 또 예선에서 김경모 선수가 김민철 선수를 상대로 승리를 거뒀단 말이죠.
네.
강력한 저그를 또 이기고 올라온 김경모 선수인데 의식이 좀 되진 않으세요?
솔직히 저전 경무 형 그래도 잘한다고 생각하고 그래서 좀 방심하면은 진짜 쓸릴 수도 있다고 생각하고 있어서 조심해야 될 것 같아요.
오늘 김경모 선수가 좀 탱커 역할을 인터뷰에서 해주고 계시는데 김현중 선수가 일단 김경모 선수는 좀 쉬운 상대다라고 이야기를 했어요. 조일장 선수도 작년, 재작년에 김경모 선수에게 패배했던 거 그다지 기억에 남지 않는다라는 좀 답변을 해주신 것 같은데 김경모 선수는 어쨌든 승리했던 기억 머릿속에 남아 계실 것 같거든요.
원래 안 좋았던 기억은 빨리 있는 게 좋으니까 있는 거를 추천하고 그리고 윤중이는 항상 저한테 좀 약간 좀 센 척을 해요. 근데 저한테 좀 강하기도 한데
네.
집에서 딱 보기 좋네요. 바로 지고 나서 이불 깔고 자면 될 것 같아요.
빠르게 탈락할 김윤중 선수의 모습을 좀 김경호 선수는 기대하고 계시는 것 같은데 자 다음 질문은 김윤중 황병영 선수에게 드려보도록 하겠습니다. 비조의 승부 예측 역시 좀 쉽지가 않다라고들 많이 말씀을 하고 계시는데 이 선수와의 승부가 오늘 조에서 가장 어려울 것 같다라고 생각하는 경기가 있으실 것 같아요. 황병현 선수는 어떤 선수와의 경기가 좀 가장 쉽지 않겠다라고 생각을 하시나요?
저는 1장 형이 제일 힘들 것 같아요. 원래 평소에도 많이 지기도 해가지고 1장 형 전을 좀 많이 준비했는데 경계가 되네요. 네.
저그전을 좀 많이 준비해 오신 것 같은데 김윤중 선수는 오늘 어떤 선수와의 대결이 가장 좀 신경 쓰이시나요?
저는 어차피 김경모는 깔고 간다는 마인드고 뭐 1장이나 1등을 올려보내면 이제 남은 선수가 황병영인데 황병영 선수가 조금 그래도 까다로운 선수예요.
네.
연습도 많이 하기 때문에 황병영 선수가 좀 조심해야 되지 않을까 제가 황병영 선수를
그러면 테란전을 좀 비중 있게 준비를 하셨을까요, 김윤중 선수?
네, 테란전을 그래도 많이 준비했습니다. 네.
아, 알겠습니다. 김경모 선수도 이런 질문이 있었습니다. 가티어와 잭티어로 오고 가는 2단계 승급과 강등이 반복된다는 얘기를 하셨는데 상대하게 될 선수들을 지켜보셨을 때 김경모 선수 오늘 가티어의 느낌인지 잭티어의 느낌인지 대답을 해주시죠.
근데 제가 대회 때는 그래도 긴장 안 하는 편이라 가지고 오늘은 좀 가티어 실력이 나올 것 같아요. 네, 생각을 그렇게 하고 있습니다.
중간에 살짝 텀이 있었는데 신중한 답변을 해주셨습니다. 자, 마지막 질문입니다. 오늘 뭐 모든 선수들이 진출하겠다라는 마인드로 경기에 임하시겠지만 만약 광탈하게 된다면 이것까지 하겠다, 공약을 좀 걸겠다 하는 그런 부분이 있으실지도 좀 궁금해하시는 것 같아요. 요거는 우리 김윤중 선수가 또 엄청난 자신감을 보여주셨기 때문에 김윤중 선수 혹시 가장 먼저 탈락한다면 이것까지 할 수 있다, 뭐가 있을까요?
가장 먼저 탈락이요? 아까 제일 먼저 떨어진다는 거죠?
네.
지금
김윤중 선수의 시나리오엔 없는 그림일 것 같긴 한데
그렇죠.
네네.
저는 뭐 막말로 뭐 제 온몸에 있는 털을 다 자른단 마인드죠. 눈썹, 뭐 겨드랑이 털 다 자른단 마인드입니다. 그 정도로
네.
자신 있습니다. 예.
너무 강력한 공약을 내걸어 주셨기 때문에 다른 선수들이 공약을 걸기도 좀 쉽지 않아 보입니다. 자, 그러면 마지막으로 각 선수들에게 각오를 좀 짧게 여쭤보도록 하겠습니다. 우리 현장에 함께 계시지 못한 김윤정 선수의 각오 들어보겠습니다.
우선은 저는 오늘 3명 중에 2명이 올라간다고 생각해요. 1명은 없다고 생각합니다. 깨모 선수. 그렇기 때문에 너무 자신이 있고 3분의 2죠. 한번 화이팅 해보도록 하겠습니다. 화이팅! 네.
네, 화이팅입니다. 우리 김경문 선수의 각오를 좀 들어볼까요? 강하게 한마디 해주세요.
근데 윤중이가 저렇게 자신있게 말하니까 좀 약간 쫄리긴 하는데요. 그래도 뭐 대회니까 제가 김윤중 탈락시키도록 하겠습니다.
기대하겠습니다. 자, 황병현 선수 각오 말씀해 주시죠.
저도 오늘 준비 많이 해서 좋은 경기 보여드릴 수 있도록 하겠습니다.
네, 좋습니다. 기대하겠습니다. 조일장 선수.
네, 저번 시즌 많이 아쉬웠던 만큼 이번 시즌에는 또 잘해서 높이 올라갈 수 있도록 하겠습니다.
네, 네 분 모두 인터뷰 감사드리고요. 멋진 비주얼 경기 기대하겠습니다. 고맙습니다. 자, 나의 레벨은 다르다 어나더레벨 핫식스와 함께하는 ASL 시즌 14 강 비조 경기를 앞두고 있습니다. 과연 어떤 선수들이 16강으로 향하게 될지 지금부터 경기를 통해 확인해 보시죠.
Hey, what is up, everybody? Welcome to day two of the ASL season 14. Day one kicked a lot of ass. I am excited to bang out this recording. Artosis, how are you doing?
Man, I'm just happy to be here once again. It felt so good to start with Group A and just get to cast some top pro level StarCraft 1 once again. And here we are in Group E. It looks like Shuttle will not be joining everyone at the studio. That's too bad, but... it's a great group. We were talking about it a little bit during Group A, how this is like quietly a very, very, very strong group.
Yeah, we ended the last show. I was talking about like maybe this actually is the most interesting group. Again, I think it's a group that's hard to call. Group A was sort of easy. We did have the upset that Mini did not actually come out first, but he did make it through. So he's definitely a guy I've got my eyes on here. And by the way, guys, we're going to be banging out these recordings pretty quickly. I know for every season of ASL, we always have a little bit of a later start. We have to get the graphics set up. But once the system's in place, and that system now is in place, you're going to see these VODs come out pretty quickly. So we appreciate your patience. And I also appreciate your patience with me, with my COVID. I am still sick. I was... I don't know. I was extremely sick again this morning. I thought I wouldn't be able to do it, and then I rested. I took a nap for 4 hours, and I feel like I'm okay. So, but I'll try to do my best to to keep my foggy brain on point here.
Well, I got to tell you, it's actually impressive that you're casting a couple days in a row while you have COVID and you're still feeling sick. Like, I mean, it hits everyone different, right? Like, I only had two very sick days, but... to see you to troop through and actually do a broadcast. If you had told me, you could have put a gun to my head when I had and be like, you're casting ASL tonight. I'm like, nah, pull the trigger. I'm not doing it.
Kill me now.
It's just not happening.
So we're looking at the tier list here for the pros. I don't know about this tier list. I do feel like when they do this at a freaking TV, this feels a bit forced. It kind of looked better for Group A, but for this, I'm like, I don't know if this is really like a tier 1, 2, 3, 4 lineup.
Yeah, I think it's literally just they have a point scheme for how deep you make it into recent ASLs. I think that's exactly what it comes down to.
Yeah, I think so.
And it's like, yeah, Hero keeps getting like top 4 in like every ASL, and then like, you know, Gamo makes it into every ASL, but he always goes out in the first round, right? And I think Barracks made one second round or something, so I guess that's how they got it. But a lot of these players are pretty neck and neck, but maybe not this guy. Like, I would be shocked if Hero doesn't make it. I would be shocked. I think that last season and the season before, he looked like maybe the best player.
Oh, yeah.
Like, I actually think Hero's going to win an ASL in the next few.
Hero's got a very different way of playing Zerg, and his Zerg freaks me out. Like, he's one of these Zergs that I watch, and I'm like, ooh, I'll never beat you in my entire life. Like, you're so good with how you approach this, and it's a very sharp way that he plays the game. It's not so much abusive as it is, I think, optimized, if that makes sense.
Yeah, okay, okay. And I would agree, it's not, he doesn't really play an abusive style. He plays a very smart style. He reminds me of Solky a little bit, where it's like he'll figure out how to crush your army. Some of the tactics he was using, do you remember that game on like Polypoid from ASL where he forced the army to walk in this weird direction and caught the Valkyries that were trying to come up?
Yeah.
It was like the most beautiful dance ever to crush a situation that he was not supposed to win. And he crushed it. And it's like, oh my God, Hero. He's something else.
Yeah, he's a scary player. His opponent, though, I mean, this guy really, he kind of reminded me of a tough ladder Zerg, like the scary ladder Zergs that you play against, like the mm-hmm. faceless barcode warriors. This is going to be an interesting ZVZ. I do think that Hero is clearly favored here. I would be shocked if he didn't take this.
Yeah. I mean, I'm picking him to win this group, and whatever group he has in the next round, I pick him to win that, too. I'm just putting that in there ahead of time. But, I mean, Gamo is dangerous. He's strong. Yeah. He normally qualifies in the first qualifier of each season. Let's see what he can do against Hero.
Yeah, guys, we're ready. This is game one here in Group B. ASL Season 14 is on. Let's see who goes on to the winner's match between these two Zergs.
Move your head.
All right, we have Hero here in the bottom right, and in the top right, we have Gamo. And of course, it's a two-player map, so I think the ZVZ gets a little bit more straightforward in this situation, right?
I always feel like ZVZ gets more interested in a two-player map. I think there's a lot more cheeses you can do because the Overlord Scout paths are more predictable. Mm. You know?
Yeah, that's fair.
It's a little bit less of kind of a die. You know, there's whenever you're on a four-player map, there's sort of this probability puzzle you're trying to sort. Like, you know, mm-hmm. if you find them right away, there's opportunities there. But if you don't, then there's a certain set of parameters you have to follow, unless you're willing to take risks. But mm-hmm. I do think some of the wildest ZVZs have been ones where we see, you know, someone go for a quick pool and move around the Overlord, you know what I'm saying? Totally. And surprise him.
Yeah, you're actually making me remember some games now. Like, didn't Solky do some weird, like, hidden hatchery on a two-player map as
well? Yeah,
yeah,
that's right.
Maybe it was even Butter that we saw that. But, yeah, that stuff can be very, very cool. Yeah, I guess you're right. Like, just cheeses in general. Because I don't think about Zerg versus Zerg as something where, like, they're going to proxy. Or Zerg as a proxy race in general. But we have even seen that on the two-player maps. So, yeah, I guess there is a fairly large range of what can occur here, considering you know exactly where your opponent is and you know how to scout them if you need to for whatever situation.
Was it Hero, the player that went for like the 7-pool speedling build that you and I were not familiar with? Was he the guy that did that?
Oh, I can't recall, actually. It might have been. I mean, Hero has
oh, no,
like,
maybe that was
literally
so
every...
Oh, shoot. I'm wrong. Sorry, go ahead. Mm.
Well, they actually, there's a lot of overlap between them, too. Like, I think Solky and Hero are the best, like, macro Zergs rather than micro Zergs, where, like, Soma would be, like, the best micro Zerg.
Yeah.
But, yeah. Like, I mean, Hero has so many different ways that he plays this game. It's actually crazy. And he is going to field the first Zerglings out onto the map. Going to send those up. It looks like the hatchery coming a little bit quicker here for Gamo, but he's a pool first as well. And there it is. He's running around the Overlord like you were talking about.
Yeah, he's going to send these Lings out here. This was a... at least in similarity in that they both had pool gas right away. Usually the guy that gets the pool and gas a little bit later is technically in a better position if they don't get punished because they just have the extra drones. It's important to note that this is really the only matchup in the whole game where you have Warcraft 3 levels of workers, or even less.
Yes, that's right. And you're attacking with your little ghouls, but they can't mine wood because there's no wood on
that's
the map.
That's right. They're going to come in and kill his acolytes, Artosis. Oh, good scout here. Kamo's going to find him here. And This is going to be a pretty big attack. I mean, I see Tooling's hatching. I don't know if more drones are going to hatch. That's going to be the big tell on how Gamo's going to be able to handle this.
Yeah, look at this. Like, oh my god, the flank is absolutely fantastic. I love the one Ling in with the drones too. Really, really high IQ plays here. But two drones fall immediately. The other Ling's attacking the hatchery. These Ling's going into the main base. The drone's being pulled to the gas. And he does pull back in fear of that drone drill.
Keep in mind, there's only four.
Popping out for Gamo now.
Yeah, only four workers are mining right now. So, I mean, right now, Hero wants to not only try to do damage, but also lengthen the time this is going to take where, okay, hold it. This is a great surround here. Hero's going to come in here. The drones are misplaced. They're going to get here a little bit too late. And
Hero's
Gamo's on the ropes.
Yeah, Hero's doing a fantastic job. Gamo is trying so hard to fight back here. But, like, even if he holds this, the Spire is already making. He's got to get those drones back on the minerals.
Yeah, no kidding. And look, Hero's doing the right job of both doing damage, and then he runs away. He's like, all right, nope. Let's keep the pressure on here. Let's not overextend. Let's generate the threat. And he may actually continue to pursue here. Let's see. I don't see a Lair or a Spire even here for Gamo. So he's going to have to go for an Evo Chamber and a Spore. And this just puts the defending Zerg in an extremely uncomfortable spot. And even right now, I'm not sure if he's going to be able to even last through this. Now, remember, it's two hatches versus one. Hero being the aggressor has the one. So that's half the production. But the tech is very strong. And even if Gamo survives the Muta pressure, there's nothing that he can really do to stop Hero from also expanding as well.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah, and I think that it's pretty clear here that he actually has to go for a Ling all in. You see Hero, he's already prepared for it. He's making three Mutas, I think, right now to go help defend in this two Ling counterattack. Oh, just absolutely devastating,
Gamo's
man.
Not even watching, actually. He's so busy being a micro guy over here at the entrance that he actually lost half his drones in the main from four to two. This should end within the next minute, I think, right?
Oh, I think as soon as the Mutas hit his base, he's going to GG, to be honest. Like, the Spore is going to be too slow. There's already a Sunk going up in Hero's main. Hero just absolutely mangling Gamo.
Dude,
like,
I mean,
this
is
not even close.
Judo flip of a game. Total punish here. Again, Hero very crafty with hiding those Lings and getting the closure here with these Mutas. And, I mean, I think these Mutas can kill all these drones before the Spore is even done. GG. A short game to start it off, but that is what most CVZs are.
Yeah, that was really expertly played from Hero. Even though Gamo scouted the Lings on the side that were trying to come in, the unbelievable pressure, the multitasking here of Hero, the sleekness of the build order, and that the call to pull back when he did, I think, was the biggest part, where he pulled back, he made his Lings into that line at the choke, because he realized, okay, the only thing he can do here is counter Ling all in. And that just allowed his Mutas to win. So beautifully played game from Hero, just showing his level.
Yeah. Really, really great game from Hero. You know, as Artoza said, I think Hero is one of the maybe five, six guys that we're looking at as, like, extremely likely to get to the very end of an ASL. And I think you're 100% on, Artoza, that Hero's going to win an ASL here.
Yeah, yeah. He's been top four like four times since he got back, and he was in the finals against Flash, and like even Flash has spoken of him as the Zerg he respects the most. And like, I mean, the guy is just, he's unbelievably strong, and we see that here. I think he's just gonna, like, it's gonna take someone special to take him down this season. Someone like Beast or Light.
Yeah, well, I mean, that's that, guys. We're going to go to a break. Shuttle versus Barracks should be a longer match, I'm sure. And we'll go to that now, guys.
X. 맛있는 탕 제로. 요즘 제일 탐나는 제로 탕수 제로 같이 떠나볼래? 아침엔 라떼 헐릭 점심엔 라떼 헐릭 저녁엔 라떼 헐릭 동그랗게 달콤하게 라떼 헐릭 달달한 충전이 필요할 땐 칸타타 라떼 헐릭
형님 아프리카의 승부의 예측 생긴 거 아세요 여러분들?
네? 아니 e스포츠 여기 탭에 있잖아요 여러분들 아니 이게 새로 생겼더라
저는 광동에 올인했어요
아 진짜요? 네. 아 그럼 전 DRX에 올인
모바일도 똑같이 아래 가운데 보면 e스포츠 있어요
잼이라는 포인트가 있어요 아프리카 내에서 쓸 수 있는 재화라고 생각하시면 돼요
잼을 사은품으로 교환 가능하다고요?
이 잼으로 응모로 다 할 수 있어
키보드는 벌써 나갔네 아이폰 갤럭시 탭 아 이게 200잼이야?
교환까지 할 수 있으니까 형님들 아프리카 승부의 즉 많이 많이 사랑 부탁드립니다 박수 부탁드립니다
What's up, everybody? Welcome back to the ASL. We're going to go into a PVT that should be longer and probably a little bit more dramatic than that ZVC that we just saw. Hero did win, and I don't know, man. It's what I expected. He played extremely well. Again, a very scary Zerg player. Probably going to be the first to get out of this group.
Yeah, looking very strong. But before we get into this next match, we do want to thank you guys for subscribing on the Patreon. It's ASL English on patreon.com. And yeah, thank you. Sorry about the delay and everything. We've already been talking about that quite a bit, but happy that we finally have this going. And yeah, I'm looking forward to the season, man. It's got a great lineup of players. We got some new at least one very new player in there. Of course, all the old veterans. And, you know, like you were talking about with Hero, there are five or six guys that we're really looking at as possible victors this season.
Yeah, it's going to be an interesting season. I think it's one that you can't say that you're certain you know who's going to move on. So, I don't know, man. StarCraft 1's in a great place. It's so cool to see the game reinvigorated out here. It's so good to have audiences here. I know that, you know, for this round of the tournament, the audiences are kind of small. But it really does fill out the studio as we get further and further along here.
Mm-hmm. Well, up here we have Shuttle, of course, playing from home. We're going to see how he's able to go at it. Like, obviously, he is an ASL champion. That first season, though, was kind of... I don't know what to call it. Like, it was like not a glitch season, but no one was really ready for ASL. You know what I mean? Where, like, no one was really in full shape. Like, the top four was, like, him and Mong and, like, Sharp and I forget who else. But it was not a top four that we would ever see again.
Well, it was kind of the StarCraft 1 Dark Ages, if you want to call it that, right? This was, like, you know, StarCraft 1 had a very strong showing even into the launch of StarCraft 2. And then there was this downtime where Afrika TV wasn't hosting stuff. There wasn't a major Star League. Well, Afrika TV had stuff they hosted, but not like studio stuff like this, right? Not a Star League.
Yeah.
And StarCraft Remastered wasn't out. So, you know, they picked up the StarCraft 1 League, and that was the one that Shuttle won. But, you know, once the big prize pools and sponsors, and especially when streaming really picked up as well out here, like it has everywhere in the last, you know, 5 to 6 years, streaming's really taken off. That's when Shuttle won, but, you know, a lot of the big players have stepped back in. All right, we're actually ready to jump into this, guys. We'll talk about Barracks 2 after the game starts, trust me, but this could be Shuttle versus Barracks. Game 1, the winner goes on to face off against Hero in the winner's match.
Right, in the top right, we have Shuttle playing the red Protoss. And in the bottom right, the blue Terran, we have Barracks.
Barracks with bug-eyed right now, man. He's seen a ghost in the game.
Dude, he's watching for that probe to come in and steal his gas. He's ready.
Barracks looks like he's seeing that lady from The Ring crawl out of his PC monitor right now. So, you know, Barracks also an extremely popular streamer out here. This guy, definitely, I think, a threat overall in the tournament. I would not put him in the upper echelons. Like, he's certainly not a guy I would ever expect to win an ASL. Mm-hmm. But you don't want to count him out.
Yeah, no, he's really good, man. Like, he's hitting every single season. which is like very impressive. As soon as you start qualifying for like every season and not dropping out at all, that's like the next level, right? Because there's a lot of people that like pop in and pop out. But he's very steady with that. He's definitely one of the world's best Terrans. But yeah, he's definitely not like a championship quality as of yet. I would not put him like top three Terran in the tournament or anything like that. But I mean, he's good enough. He can beat anybody.
Yeah,
and
for
by
sure.
the way, that was a very, very fast depot in barracks right there.
Yeah, I actually was doing a double take there, trying to. So the reason for that is that he doesn't want his gas stolen. He doesn't want the nuisance of the probe being inside of his base. We should point out that on Shuttle's side of the map, he basically opted to go for pylon at his entrance and gateway, and normally that is followed up with a gas steal into an expand. It's basically what we saw Mini do, actually.
Mm-hmm.
This, like, that the Group A game kind of pairs nicely with this one, where we're seeing Terran basically take the preventative measures to not get in the pickle that they were in earlier.
He's kind of taken it into his own hands. Now, the probe could have come down more quickly, and if it had, that could have actually made this a very difficult, very gross situation. But you see that Shuttle is actually going with the flow of this game really, really well. Like, he's doing constant probe harassment on the SCV, and a lot of that becomes luck. Like, where does the SCV bounce to?
Right.
But he's putting that pressure on, and then he sees something's building there, but obviously he's going to know that that's the factory. That's like the time the factory starts. But yeah, if Shuttle goes like directly into pressure against the wall and Barracks isn't able to get like a bunker out here quickly, that could be a great play for him.
Yeah.
I'm not sure if that's what he's going to go for, though.
You know, it's funny. What this actually starts to look like here is kind of a like 1998 game. Right, where the Terran's walled off right away, and there's going to be a Dragoon hurrying down here to shoot the depot. One of the reasons why in the modern game you don't see that as much is Terran does everything to ensure that they're going to have control over their natural, because any developed RTS game, usually they've really mapped out how to get the second base up.
Yeah. And honestly, in this situation, this is such a strange one. I haven't seen anyone do this on Butter as of yet. I feel like my mind is kind of racing about the possibilities of having this as an opener, and then like how could Protoss counter it? Because one of the big reasons why walls went away is because it's actually really hard to come out of your wall and to defend the wall against goon pressure and stuff like that. Also, it can choke up macro later on. But here, like, Shuttle played like almost too honorably, you know what I mean? Like, I would be saying thank you. I'm like, oh wow, you didn't make a Zealot, you didn't really rush Dragoon range, right? You're not, and this is allowing Barracks to very calmly take his natural expansion.
Yeah, I agree. I mean, this is there's nothing wrong with how either side's playing, but it's very I'm trying to find the right word. I don't want to make it sound like it's, because it's not boring, right? But it's I think a withdrawn way to play from Shuttle, which is not bad. He's basically just in a hurry to get into mid game.
Yeah, it seems that way. And he might not have been prepared for that wall. Like, he probably had a gas steel build ready.
Yeah.
So the fact that Barracks took that away from him, he's just kind of falling back on a very standard PVT opener. But either way, we are going to have a little push coming out from Barracks. And one of those goons has already taken a lot of damage here.
You got to be careful as Protoss, because, you know, the Dragoons are very strong against Terran, but you don't have a lot of them. So, like, when one takes a bunch of damage, it's a problem. This is an interesting matchup in that each side has, like, a small set of units. Mm-hmm. And each one of those units has a very important role, like this Vulture does. You know, the Vulture is killed in six shots from a Dragoon, so you got to be careful. At the same time, you know, if the Marines and the tank can just get close to any of these goons and shoot it down, sometimes you can be killed with a push. And I might be wrong, but I don't see SCVs being made from Barracks in the last shot or two we had. I think he's actually going to do a timing attack here.
That would be interesting. Like, he has been making the Marines nonstop. It's not uncommon to make a couple additional Marines with some tanks to push everything back to lay mines on the map. You know, that kind of gets the contain away from your base. I'm not sure. Like, he is adding a second factory, so he should be putting the pressure on. Look at that, though. That is That is a lot of Marines. Like, he's pretty serious about this.
Yeah, I mean, he did a pretty good job with kind of zoning with the Vulture, just creating a threat that it kind of pulled Shuttle back. Mm-hmm. Now, I want to be clear, this can go either way depending on control. You can have games like this play out 100 times, and like sometimes the Terran wins, sometimes the Protoss wins. It just kind of depends on the footsies and how they set this all up. And so he's going to put mines over here on the side. It does plant. He does see it with the Observer, excuse me.
And look, now he has Siege Mode ready during the push. This is a fascinating build from Barracks. Like, I've never seen exactly this. Super cool, though. Now the goons are going to try to come in. He has 8 goons, which is definitely enough to kill tanks, but getting on top of those tanks can be a bit rough.
Oh my god, this mine!
Oh my god! Okay. He kills 2 tanks but loses 8 goons, Tasteless. That can't be a good trade.
And with the gateway as part of the wall, I mean, he should have 2 more back at his main, but that's going to be a big punish to the production here. And now he can get up to where the probes are. He tries to drag a mine with that Dragoon into the Marines, but it doesn't hit a single Marine. And now a second bunker's being made here. And keep in mind, if the Protoss is contained, it's a pretty perilous game, man. It's extremely hard to ever recover from that.
But he's still trying to fight. There's only 1 tank. Oh, God, the probes are all going to start falling now. So I think that this is going to get from bad to worse at this point. But I think he will save the Nexus, right? Like, the probes come out to fight with 1 tank left. He never got the Marines into a bunker.
I kind of can't believe this overextension here. This is wild to me.
Yeah, well, once you kill the tanks, that's like, the thing is, ranged goons massacre Marines, right? And then he, like, used his probes to fight. But, like, the amount of probes that were lost, the fact that Barracks does have a couple factories at home, I still definitely like his position here, right? It's a super late third. It's not like Shuttle has anything great going on.
Yeah, again, I think Barracks could have done a better job back there. He sort of jumped the shark, so to speak. You know, it's okay to take your time a little bit and not try to get that closer, but now the Protoss is in good shape. Once you break that push, the Protoss has a lot more freedom on the map.
Yeah, and yeah, I mean, with his 3 gates, he's going to be able to field an army that can kind of, you know, prevent any further damage, at least for now. And he is going into Reaver, which is going to be very, very solid, because there's a lot of options here for Barracks. Like, he can actually go into a secondary push based on the amount of stuff that he killed, or he can go ahead and just play a macro game. And either one, I think the Reaver tech is very nice against.
Yeah, I think that anytime you have a game where you survive a push as Protoss, a quick one like that, I mean, I think Reaver tech is a must. Because
I agree.
The Reaver, it just, first of all, one of the most common follow-ups, and I think maybe the best and most logical follow-up, is to just mass up factories, like we see him doing here, right? Because if you try to make a command center or go for a starport, it's like, well, they just see that, right? Mm-hmm. You gave up an eBay early on if you're going to do a build like this. So you basically go for a powering push, which gives it, it's like a 6-4 matchup at this point in time for the Protoss. Like, your push failed. It doesn't mean the Protoss can't die to the push, but they probably shouldn't if both sides play perfectly.
Go ahead. I was just going to say, like, also, he doesn't have to push. Like, you can go 5-fact and just make a third command.
Yeah, that's true, too.
And just be like, this, like you said, I think one of the important things that people need to realize is Protoss sees what you're doing, like, always in these situations, and so they have to prepare for the push, whether it's going to come or not. So, like, expanding sometimes can be good. If you think, like, oh, I think they're going to hold it, and you just expand, and Protoss is sitting there with all these units, and they're like, oh, okay, well, I can't really attack into that, so I guess I expand, too.
Yeah, It's a funny thing. I think it creates a tighter game, if that makes sense. By the way, this push coming out here. Okay, he does see it with the Observer. I was going to say, this is one of the tricks Terran can do to try to kind of run around to an unusual side of the map. But you got to be careful, because as long as they have pylon walls like that one, you can basically chase down the tanks. And remember, Dragoons are actually a little bit faster than tanks. So if you don't have anything protecting... and especially here, if he had dropped on that mine, that would have been huge. But he's going to have a Reaver in here, and he's going to catch these tanks here. with this. And these are just big shots going off.
He might even...
Oh my god, this is brutal!
Oh, the reverb! So good! Oh my god, yeah, Shuttle is just doing such a fantastic job chasing this down. I really think Barracks, like, I did not mind the position he was in.
Yeah.
But that push was a bit too quick. He moved out with, like, 8 tanks or something. Like, I don't think he took stock of the situation very well. Because getting caught like that, like, you're right, goons are faster. You can't retreat with siege tanks. Like, you... Every move you make with them has to be the correct move. So I feel like he should have actually just waited a bit longer. Sometimes Terrans feel pressured when they're trying to go for an attack to just, like, go. But you see what can happen there. Like, he lost, like, 7 tanks or something basically for free. Whereas yeah. if he had taken his time and, like, gotten... Like, look what he's doing with these vultures. He's getting so much vision. He knows where everything kind of is. Wait for this type of intel. Mass up a little bit more so the Protoss can't just run you over and then decide if you're going to push.
You know, it's a concept I want to mention here because, and by the way, going for Storm, I think, is the absolute perfect play. Once they've been on 2 base for a long time, is to basically just smother the army. I think going for Carriers or Arbiter, that is not bad, right? Like, those are always kind of great choices, but... I think the Templar's play is just better because you're going to have this big blob of Terran units and you want to just wipe it out. Just to kind of rewind for a second here what we were talking about, and I think this is worth mentioning because we have new RTS games coming out like Stormgate. It's important to always notice when you look at a game which ranged units are faster than other units. Because a lot of times that will dictate whether or not when you lose a fight, you just lose the game because you can't retreat. Does that make sense?
Yes, absolutely. Yeah, like that's one of the most important things. Like, speed and range are the two most powerful upgrades in RTS and the two most important to look at for unit interaction.
Yeah, because, like, a moment like that, the tanks are running, it's like, well, they're not vultures, right? Like, when vultures run away, like, usually one or two die, but, like, they get away, right? But, like, when tanks run, the Dragoons can chase down and mow down a bunch of them.
Yeah. Yeah. Tanks can't really run away from everything. So much of Terran is hinged upon not screwing up with your siege tanks because they're very powerful, but they just have to be used correctly. They have to be in the right spot. But honestly, look at this. Like, Barracks is macroing well. It's just that Shuttle has a lot of bases going up, right? He's going up to 4 bases. He has a lot of supply, but not enough supply to kill Barracks, I think. Like, Barracks is very smartly making a lot of missile turrets. He has mines in his main base. He's got a good spread. So I think if Shuttle attacks in here, that's like the worst thing he could do. I think you're supposed to just slow Barracks from taking his additional bases and just continue macroing as we see from him.
Yeah, I agree. The next big step we want to watch for, and it's really going to be on the Terran side here, is... Can he get a third base? If he doesn't get a third base, this game kind of dries up, right? One thing about this map is, like, none of the third bases are actually easy for the Terran to take. I guess compared to some other maps, right? Some maps, like, the third base is a freebie, right? This map is not one of them, which is probably why we saw that push come out, by the way, from the Terran.
Definitely could be.
Okay, this is a big catch. You got to be careful being too close to a powered-up 2-base Terran as Protoss, because this can happen. I mean, that was, I think, 7 or 8 Dragoons, which is a lot.
Yeah. That was a little bit... that was definitely a mistake that we just saw there from Shuttle. Like, that's a... Anytime you can do that as Terran, and it's especially on maps like this or maps like Eclipse that have very... different lanes, right? You can't do something like that really on Polypoy because everything joins up immediately. But here it's like, okay, these lanes are so vastly different, you can't actually go over and help units in that area. The units that are there are there, and the vultures can run up and surround. And that's just a great pickoff, right? Like, you got to now remake, like, 8 more Dragoons.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. And winning little fights like that is extremely important. So we're going to see the attempted bust. Protoss is maxed out, by the way. I'm sorry, where are the Templars here?
Yeah, I'm not sure where they are. I saw some on the side of the map, but we definitely don't see any here. Now, look at this. He actually got a pretty decent scarab there and some Zealots coming in. Oh, God, the double Reaver land on the side of the siege tanks. We'll pick off some more. And this, I think, was pretty damn good for Shuttle, but the game is not completely over yet. I think that right now, Barracks has to move Vultures out in the map. Like, if he does not get out there and at least deny a base, this game is going to end.
Yeah, and it does feel like we're getting closer and closer to the end of this game in general here for the Terran. Their supply is evened out, but Shuttle's supply is going to spike back up shortly here. So now we've got the Reavers landing once more. Trying to just, you know, buy time. This is going to be do or die here. I think it's very unlikely Terran can make the push work, but he's got to try. He doesn't have a lot of options. Keep in mind, the production point is all from one source. So as scary as Protoss is, if you put a bunch of tanks and Vultures out like at the natural, you can then fork off tanks and kill off all the other bases and basically win that way.
That's exactly what he's going for. That's why he's brought his SCVs as well. He's going to throw down missile turrets. This is a great minefield. He's already spread his tanks reasonably well. I agree that I don't think this is going to end up working out for him, but it's a great idea because if he gets that containment, you're right. He can start sending off smaller groups and picking off bases.
Ooh, this is a great scarab shot here. Can the Vultures block? No.
He tried. He really tried. That would have been amazing if they had, but he loses extra units. Oh, man. Very good play there by Shuttle, though. He's doing a fantastic job picking off everything on the edges.
Okay, the tanks are going to keep inching up here. It does feel like Protoss has exactly what you need to bust this, right? There's so many Shuttles here. There's enough Zealots to probably soak mines anyways, but I gotta say, Barracks has a pretty scary position here. This is all gonna come down to if he can break it. Here we go.
Yeah, here come the Shuttles on top of absolutely everything. Wow, a huge mine hit upon those Zealots. The Shuttles actually fly past?
Oh my god.
Where are they going? I don't even... Like, the Shuttles... Dude, the Shuttles are in the middle of the map. I don't know what's going on right now.
Did he
attack
those?
Move them with everything?
He didn't, right?
I don't even know if they had units in them at this point.
No, they
but
for sure
suddenly
had.
Barracks is going to win this game.
Well, if you don't break it down right, what's weird is I saw him load up Templars and then I didn't see like the storms I was expecting. The idea is that you have like four storms that basically soften this all up. Yeah, Artosis, I think that Barracks is the favorite right now. I mean, we're not out of the woods yet, but.
Yeah, the Shuttles are like sitting in the middle of the map. I think that Shuttle has literally lost the Shuttles. You know how sometimes you lose a unit? Like, it's not on a hotkey, so you're like, oh, did it die? Okay. You know, I think that's the situation that we're in right now, because they're just sitting there. There's no reason for those Shuttles to be down there.
Okay, I mean, the Protoss is contained. Basically, what we talked about, you know, Barracks needing to do, he did it. And now you see, like, you know, as scary as Protoss is, especially on these maps like this where there's not, like, another main to make a bunch of gateways, this becomes a problem, right? Because Protoss are always bad against Terran if it's really bottlenecked because siege tanks and mines are so strong in congested areas. Yeah. And, like, look, he just has to fraction off a tank or two here or there. Let's see if these Shuttles have stuff in them.
I know. I don't know if they do or not.
I almost want to like have an instant replay of that because I kind of, to be honest, I don't always watch when the Zealots come out for the drop because that's sort of a given, right? But I felt like certainly he didn't unload enough.
They flew right over the army, man. Like, I wasn't watching either because I just assume what's going to happen. And I just kind of keep my eye ready for spellcasters. But nothing was exploding back there. The Shuttles just flew over. Maybe they were empty. I'm not entirely sure. He's going to bring him in from the side this time and actually start to unload. But this setup is, I think it's just too strong for Barracks.
Yeah, not even 2-1, just 1-1. But, I mean, this is going to be enough. Now, let's watch the Psy Storms. That's a really good storm. That's about as good as you could ask for. Can he get another one or two?
Wow.
The problem
he's still going to break it.
As much as we watch this position now, we need to look at, see, this base is gone. The base to the upper right on the minimap up there is gone. And so, yeah, I mean, the Protoss breaks free, but he doesn't have the same kind of engine behind him to produce. So I think that Terran is still, I think, quite fairly in the lead here. And I think even setting up another contain here is going to be not hard at all, right? I mean, look, he's just going to rally more units across the map. I'm sure the armory upgrades are going to finish in a second here.
Barracks is definitely in a much better spot. Like, look at Shuttle's supply, man. He's got, like, no income coming as well.
Oh, look at that big sigh.
This is terrible.
Yeah, there it is, GG. Very Korean sigh. And so Barracks wins. I got to say, man, props to him. Do not give up. He fought back really well.
That was a really back-and-forth game when you think of it, too. The initial push from Barracks, I thought he was really far ahead. Then Shuttle held, and I was like, okay, I think it's still fine for Barracks. And then Barracks threw seven tanks, and I'm like, wow, Shuttle's way ahead. And then you know, Barracks does this crazy push there when he really looked like he was dead after getting busted in front of his base. I can't believe it. What a crazy back-and-forth game.
Yeah, that was a fun one to cast. I think that really illustrates one way for Terran to beat Protoss is you, and especially on a map like Butter, you get the contain first, and then it's divide and conquer, right? Fork out to these bases, take that out. Again, you know, if you lose big chunks of goons like that early on, it can allow Terran to get that one position they need, and that's that. So up next, guys, TBZ, Hero versus Barracks. We're going to go to that after this short little break. Stick around.
초반에 지금 여기서 병력 뽑아서 초반부터 근데 생각을 김명훈 선수 하고 있고요.
막바지 눌렀고요. 네. 원질러 뽑고 다시 넥서스 준비를 하려는 이런 그 분위기를 한번 보이다가 질럿을 다시 한번 이번엔 또 찍었거든요.
자, 길목 쪽에서
쪽만 들어가야 돼요. 저거 입장에서는.
본진화 쪽에 어쨌든 프로브도 잡고 상대의 테크가 못 올라가도록 좀 괴롭혀야 본인의 어쨌든 가난한 출발이 좀 상쇄될 수 있는 상황이 되거든요. 바롭도 됐고 정우링도 지금은 한 분에 가량 모이고 있는 이런 상황에서 입구 쪽에 순위 라인이 형성이 안 돼 있으면 나머지는 되게 좀 그렇죠. 불안할 수밖에 없죠.
이제 포지션이 완성되는 상황에서요. 질럿이 많지가 않거든요. 하나.
네.
아, 이거 괜찮은데요. 그럼 하나가 좀 나오긴 했습니다.
새로 온 정글링을 먼저 습격해서 머리 숫자를 좀 줄여는 데 성공을 했는데 케이트웨이가 언파워드 됐다라는 것이
어떻게 나올 때까지 막 버티면서 패로까지 지어져야 되거든요.
지금 죽고 있는 상황인데요. 지금 또 와요.
막히게 되면 저는 할 게 없어집니다.
아니, 이게 완성된다고요?
캐논 완성되기 전에 이게 승부 못 보면
이게 질럿 나왔고
질럿을 너무 잘 아끼고 프로페 어쨌든 포지션도 좋고요.
그렇죠. 이걸 막아요.
더 이상 정울림이 난입될 수도 이거 캐논 완성되거든요.
네. 지금 완성됐습니다. 캐논 완성됐어요. 이제 못 들어오죠.
본진 쪽에도 캐논이 완성됐어요.
이후에 김명훈 선수 그래도 지금 해처 늘리면서 좀 어떻게든 운영을 통해서 상대를 끊어내야 되는데 질럿 숫자가 좀 쌓였고요.
질럿으로 공굴리기를 여기까지 너무 잘해냈거든요.
자, 이제 지금 뮤탈이 나온 상황인데요. 여기서 드론 자원체에 대한 피해 어느 정도까지 들어갈지. 이거 시켜야죠.
더 추가해요.
자, 이게 깨지면 사실 까도 굉장히 무서운 말이에요.
명운을 대표하는 유인신 히드라로 정말 어느 정도 눈물겹게 버텨야 되는 상황입니다.
뮤탄 숫자가 많지 않기 때문에
챌린! 버그의 가장 빛나는 태양이었던 김경훈 선수를 완벽하게 가리는 그런 어둠이 변현재 선수가 아닐까라는 생각이 듭니다.
Welcome back, everybody. Thank you for waiting. It's time to get a player to escape from Group B and go to the next round of the ASL Season 14. This is going to be Hero versus Barracks. This should be a really interesting one. As well as Barracks has played today, I do still think that Hero is the clear favorite. But look, Barracks had a pretty crazy comeback against Shuttle. Maybe he can surprise us here against Hero.
Yeah, I mean, it's a best of one. And while I would certainly say Hero's a better player, best of one, Zerg versus Terran, if you screw something up, a player of Barracks caliber may be able to kill you, right? Like, you overextend with your mutas one time or throw away some Zerglings, like, and he's doing a heavy Marine play, maybe you get run over, right? And if it does get into a big game, those get mighty sloppy with irradiates all over the place, dropships, all that. So anything can happen. But, yeah, it should be a good one. We're going to be going to Allegro, which is a very solid macro map. I'm hoping we have a nice long game here.
Yeah, this should be a good one, man. Hero versus Barracks in this best of one. The winner does move on to the winner's match. The loser into the finals match. Hero, one of the scariest Zergs out there. Barracks is steadily improving, Terran. This should be a sick one, guys. We're going to hop into Allegro right now.
So we have in the top left there, Barracks. It's a beautiful magenta Terran.
A beautiful magenta right. Terran.
Dude, magenta is the best color for Terran. You can tell that Barracks is a serious Terran player by the fact that he chooses magenta as his color.
It is a good color. I've never been a fan of this kind of silver Zerg, to be honest.
No?
Yeah.
Like that one? It almost blends with the creep a little bit.
It does. I want
it's,
to
go
ahead.
Well, I think that some people might choose their color for aesthetic reasons. They're like, I like how this pops or whatever. And then I think some people choose it because they're like, this looks the worst to my opponent.
Right? When they pick brown, like, it's like this blends in with the minimap.
Yeah. But I mean, who doesn't shift the colors to red for opponent on minimap, right? And a lot of people just shift it to their teal and they're playing against red.
I want to give a quick shout out here because I've been casting with COVID. Like every 5 minutes, my girlfriend's been coming by here with tea to keep me alive. So shout outs to Miss Tasteless here. This is like, you know, those like F1 races where the car has to like pull over to the side and they take all the wheels off and put it back on. That's basically happening in this cast.
Oh, man.
Look at that. We got some foreigners here in the audience. If you come to Korea, guys, you got to come see StarCraft event live. There's so many great esports events to see down here. I mean, this is one of the big appeals of Seoul in general, is like literally every day there's an esports event happening, you know, that you can go see live, but you got to see the OG esport, right?
Oh, yeah. I mean, the crowds for ASL, I think, are going to get really, really big. GSL has recovered amazingly as we've opened the studio up, and honestly, ASL has more fans in Korea than GSL, so I think it's going to get popping soon, Tasteless.
It's going to be the hottest club in Gangnam. Are we going to use club terms right now?
Yeah, for sure we are. You kidding me? This is Club ASL.
So kind of a funny little thing that happened earlier. The Barracks went for CC first, and right as he sent the CC over, he sees that the Overlord saw it. Keep in mind, he doesn't know what build order Hero's doing. Let's also not forget how the last day of ASL went, where it's like Mini went for a greedy quick Nexus and barely held. He doesn't know that there's not a pool making, but interestingly enough, Hero's actually gone for three hatches before spawning pool.
Yeah, that's a strong counter, right? Like, this is probably the best thing that you could do if you're not already going for... Oh, and the drone block is really smart, too. Like, Barracks should probably go up and attack that drone, honestly. But a second drone comes down. This is why Hero's so good, or at least part of it, right? Like, he's blocking the scouting. So here, as Barracks, Barracks will throw down a bunker, whereas he literally doesn't need to do anything. Like, there's no units coming his way for quite some time.
Yeah, this is, it's funny, like, I feel like I never say this when someone goes Barracks first and gets away from it, but I think the Zerg is in a better spot.
Yeah. Yeah, like, I mean, just the fact that he's, like, denied the scouting for this long as well. I guess the SCV finally does come up and attack that drone. Hero did not pull a second one to help out against it, so it's going to get a scout of the pool timing.
Well,
the pool is,
you know, I don't
done,
think he does,
so
actually,
he doesn't actually know when it finished.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, there's nothing you can click on to confirm that. Now, he may suspect it. You know, one thing about when you're at the highest levels, you kind of know what the opponent's supposed to have here.
Mm-hmm. Well, he definitely knows now there's another hatchery on the map.
Right.
Because he got up, and it was like 3:35, and there was no layer.
Right.
And he had known there was no layer down at the bottom, right? So he knows that there is something out on the map somewhere.
So it's kind of a funny game already. I mean, basically, this hatchery that the Zerg has in the bottom right, that's like one of the mid-game goals of the Zerg. Normally in a ZVT, right, is to try to get a hatch in another main and defend it. But this is a very different game. Now, oh, wow. Okay, we're going to see this build again, man.
Ooh.
Remember casting this last season? The double
yes.
armory. You know, we've gone to pretty extreme places right now in this game. This is actually a really
yes.
exciting, even as a Protoss player, I'm like really excited about the direction this game's taking here, because I've never casted this type of game specifically. CC first, the
yeah.
three hatch into heavy Muta tech with the Terran going for double armory. So, like, I'm not going to lie, guys, I don't even know who's actually favored here, but I do feel like it's going to be an insane slugfest of Goliaths and versus Mutalisks.
Well, this looks to me like the way this game should go, this should be an extremely long game.
Yeah. Because
if you're going double armory, you are going to at least 2-2 before an attack, right? Like, that's what makes the most sense. Like, I mean, you're just not going to have a very big army when 1-1 finishes. That's just the way of things. So, I mean, if you're going for minimum 2-2, that means that you're going to be maxed out. So, like, Barracks should not even be attacking before max supply. And if you're going mech, you're generally just, there's no way to kill you early on.
Yeah.
And Hero's economy is so big. Like, this is the greediest game from both sides that you could ever see. And it's been back and forth greed, where they're scouting each other and adjusting to be more and more greedy. Because, I mean, both of them know that if they were to attack, their opponent is just going to hold it and they're going to get behind. So we are going to see a big game now, I think.
Yeah, this is going to be fun, man. I don't know, man. I'm hyped for this one. I think I might have been wrong, though. I thought he was going to start making mutas, but I see Hydras coming out here. And I think this might be another pivot from the Zerg side, because... And look, I mean, I've played some Terran, like, historically. Like, obviously not like Yortosis or anybody who mains it, but I've sort of been familiar with mech versus, Zerg. And a lot of times it's Mass Muta, but I wonder if when he saw the Spire, he thought, okay, we're going to do a hard switch into Hydras, because Goliaths are only good against Mutas. They're not terrible against other stuff, but they're not the right unit, if that makes sense.
Yeah. Like, a little Hydra push here could be very, very strong. If you can bust the bunker, it becomes really difficult for Terran to end up holding. Oh, he's going for Lurker. Okay,
oh,
so
wow.
This is an alternate way to play it, too. Like, against mech, this can be very strong because you don't get Academy quickly. And if you don't know the Lurker, normally this is an all-in build, but Hero's economy is so big, this is not all-in. So I don't want to make seem that way. Like, he has a huge economy doing this. But normally this is just an all-in where it's like, okay, if there's not enough turrets around to see it and you make them go up the ramp, you win. So this is kind of crazy. And he has no idea. Like, look at those Goliaths going in the main. He thinks there might be Mutas coming.
Yeah. When you see the Lings come out like that, you think you're getting baited here. And so the Lurkers are going to come. Now, there's a bunker here. But again, Goliaths are not superior to Lurkers. They're actually just not good against Lurkers at all. I don't see any detection here.
He doesn't have detection. That's why you don't see it.
I actually
just don't have it.
I thought that there was a scan. That was like a thing I decided, and I was totally wrong. And so it's not even about a fight. Like, he can't do anything against this.
Oh yeah, it's very tough. Now, he walked forward to try to get this turret that's in the mineral line, and the Goliaths are actually going to walk over another lurker here and try to get some kills, and they're not going to be able to do it. So even though I said this game would probably be very long, Hero has taken the shortest route to victory, and it seems like it's going to work out, but we'll see. Like, if you can stabilize, maybe, but I think he's lost a lot of SCVs at this point as well.
Yeah, this is, I think, a little bit of an overextension. I mean, I get it, but this is like a super technical game here on both sides. Like, we went way deep into, like, people cutting corners, and then Hero basically saw this strategy that really almost has no place in a normal TBZ, right? I mean, we don't even normally have mech as kind of the default build, but we don't normally have three hatch. We don't normally have CC first into double armory either, right? But he kind of saw the direction that Barracks is wanting to play, and Hero, being the really smart player he is, he said, well, I don't have to actually go mutas. I mean, I'm ahead in so many ways. So he went for that lurker tech, and the reality is Barracks, you know, I think he might have anticipated Hydras. Even when I saw the Hydras, I thought it was going to be Hydra amassing. He did not anticipate lurkers, and we know that because he didn't even have scan. He didn't have a vessel. So,
yeah.
I mean, the game hasn't ended quite yet, but I think as far as, you know, ways to dig yourself out of this hole here for Barracks, there really aren't a lot of realities where the Terran can, you know, overcome this.
Yeah, it's a terrible situation. He is going to live, though. He's going to have a vessel very shortly here. He is getting a comsat.
Do you want to just take lurkers and put him at the bottom of the ramp at a certain angle and try to bottleneck it? I guess that can't happen now because he shot this down, but would that be the play? Kind of like when Protoss contain other Protosses with Dragoons. Like this. Exactly.
Yeah, that's definitely the most cost-efficient that you can get. This is kind of forcing the siege tank now, which is really annoying. And really, you need siege mode because you can't really come down the ramp with the tank, because then the lurkers unburrow and move forward and burrow, and then the tank has to run up the ramp, and it just becomes dirty. He might just try to run down and break it, but that would result in Goliath massacres.
Yeah.
So it's a terrible... It's too bad, because every time we see this double armory build, Tasis, I want to learn more. And every time we see it, it just gets killed immediately.
Yeah, I have this when we cast ASL where the Protoss does something weird. It's like Mitty takes a third base and he only has two gates and it's a PVZ. And I'm like, what? And then like the game ends and I go, I'll never know how he's, you know, how to do this right.
No, it's very sad. It looks like he's going to go ahead and elevator out some vultures here. Now, the vultures have some heavy lifting to do. If he wants to come back in this game, he has to basically kill all those drones right there. And then clear the lurkers very cleanly, and then get a third base up. It seems unlikely.
The dropship's going to come up here towards the main. Now, I think the army already saw it, but I also know the Overlord's going to see it, too. There's no Scourge here to catch it. Whoa, was that the tank, or was that a Goliath?
Yeah, well, it was exactly what I just said, right, where... It's like, if you try to do this without siege mode, the lurkers just run up and burrow, and the tank dies. Like, this is such a common thing to see. The tank has been exploded. There's a defiler there. The game truly is very close to over at this point.
Here comes a dark swarm. GG. Wow. All right. Well, Hero just promptly moves through this group. A real threat to take this tournament. I'll tell you, man, I really liked that game overall. That was a lot of fun.
You know, that's something that can happen against mech. It's not used that much because, honestly, like, Goliaths can beat lurkers. It's just if they can see them. And you just normally don't have a turret at your front. It's not a good place against mutas. It's pointless. So if you think that they're going mutas, like when he saw the spire, this can be a great play. And, I mean, Hero very quickly advances in such dominating fashion. He's making us look good for talking about how strong he is.
I know. Thank you, Hero. One for the casters here. Well, I mean, Barracks, I think, played a pretty good game, but that was like one of those super esoteric, super advanced games where, like, we probably won't cast that situation, maybe even for a couple more years, you know? But Hero, basically, they were both one-upping each other with greed, and then Hero beheaded him. With a quick tech jump into lurkers and kind of threw him off. And the rest was history, man. And so Hero is our victor. He survives. Three players remain in Group B. Up next, we're going to go to the loser's match.
Yeah, yeah, and that should be a good one, right? Like Game-O against Shuttle, it's going to be a lot of fun to check that out. I do believe we have an interview, though, coming up here just momentarily, right?
So that's right. Yep.
Hero was just kind of chilling in his seat. He's like, yeah, I don't need
I think he forgot about it, actually. I think he's been summoned over there now. So let's see how he's feeling.
ASL 시즌 14 24강 비조 경기와 함께하고 계십니다. 오늘 가장 먼저 16강에 오른 조일장 선수와 함께하겠습니다. 축하드립니다.
감사합니다.
분더더기 없는 깔끔한 승리로 16강에 가장 먼저 또 이름을 올리셨습니다. 경기 전에도 전혀 긴장하는 느낌을 받지 못했는데요. 오늘 이렇게 원하시는 대로 경기 잘 풀어나가신 소감 어떠신가요?
일단 오늘 운이 좀 많이 따라줬던 것 같아요. 그래가지고 생각보다 더 쉽게 올라간 것 같아서 기분이 많이 좋네요.
김경모 선수와의 경기도 그렇고 승자전에서 황병영 선수와의 경기도 그렇고 물론 보면서 상대방의 약점을 파고드는 플레이도 멋있었지만 그만큼 상대에 대한 분석이 좀 잘 됐다는 느낌이 들었거든요. 좀 경기 준비하면서 좀 스타일을 분석을 하셨나요?
일단은 1경기 같은 경우에는 제가 좀 맨날 무난하게만 하다 보니까 저글링을 한번 써보고 싶더라고요. 그래가지고 연습을 해봤는데 상황이 좀 잘 나오길래 좀 이렇게 준비하게 됐고 이 경기는 좀 서치가 잘 따라주면서 이제 조금 느낌이 와서 좀 즉흥적으로 했던 빌드인데 잘 통했던 것 같아요.
황병현 선수는 아무래도 뮤타를 기다리고 있었을 텐데 럴코를 뽑고 들어가는 이 계획까지 좀 예상을 하셨군요.
네, 사실 언제 24강인지 기억은 안 나는데 이런 똑같은 경기가 있었어요. 병영이랑 그때도 했었는데 뭔가 그때 생각이 나면서 뭔가 와 오늘도 내가 운이 좋구나 이 생각이 들더라고요.
지난 시즌에는 아무래도 16강에서 조금 빨리 탈락했던 기억 때문에 이번 시즌은 더 높은 곳까지 바라보고 계실 것 같습니다. 출발이 굉장히 가볍고 좋은 느낌이 들 것 같아요.
일단 저번 시즌 좀 광탈하면서 이번 시즌 좀 오프 경기가 오랜만이다 보니까 많이 떨리진 않을까 걱정을 했는데 생각보다 마우스 감도도 너무 잘 맞고 이제 뭔가 게임이 집중도 잘 되더라고요. 그래서 이번 시즌은 뭔가 우승할 수 있지 않을까 생각하고 있습니다.
오히려 현장에서 팬분들과 함께할 때 더 침착하고 차분하게 경기를 풀어나가는 듯한 조일장 선수인데요. 16강에서의 모습도 굉장히 기대됩니다. 팬분들에게도 인사 말씀 전해주시죠.
일단은 이제 대학교에서 또 이제 응원을 많이 해줘가지고 배려도 많이 해주고 그래서 일단은 최대한 높이 올라가 보고 싶고 항상 감사드리고 그리고 또 연습을 또 도와준 우리 명훈이 형이랑 또 지성이랑 수철이한테 너무 고맙다고 전하고 싶습니다.
네, 조일장 선수의 멋진 모습 또 16강에서도 기대하도록 하겠습니다. 진출 축하드립니다.
감사합니다.
자, 이렇게 B조에서 가장 먼저 16강에 오른 저그 선수죠. 조일장 선수와 함께했습니다.
충전이 필요할 땐 칸타타
형님들 아프리카의 승부 예측 생긴 거 아세요 여러분들?
아니 e스포츠 여기 탭에 있잖아요 여러분들. 아니 이게 새로 생겼더라.
저는 광동에 올인했어요.
아 진짜요? 네. 아 그럼 전 DRX에 올인.
모바일도 똑같이 아래 가운데 보면 e스포츠 있어요.
잼이라는 포인트가 있어요.
아프리카 내에서 쓸 수 있는 재화라고 생각하시면 돼요.
잼을 사은품으로 교환 가능하다고요?
이 잼으로 응모로 다 할 수 있어.
키보드는 벌써 나갔네. 아이폰 갤럭시 탭. 아 이게 200잼이야?
교환까지 할 수 있으니까 형님들 아프리카 승부 예측 많이 많이 사랑 부탁드립니다. 화장 부탁드립니다.
Welcome back, everybody. It's time to get rid of one of these players. I don't know who's going to win this one. I feel like Shuttle's slightly favored, but Gamo's a down and dirty Zerg, man. He could take this for sure.
Yeah, and we're actually going to be going to a map that we haven't gotten to cast yet, Odyssey. So I'm excited to learn some about that. And yeah, Gamo is, he's pretty deadly. Taking a quick look at this map right now, that looks pretty wild, doesn't it? Oh my god, you have that kind of back natural with the gate, and it has like the towers to go down there. So I think that one of the main things, I know it can be a little bit hard to see on the screen, basically the main base that they're scribbling in a little bit. You have a natural down the ramp that's very normal, and then in the back there's a gate. Now gates you cannot glitch units through. This is like a gate from single player. But there's a mineral patch there, so you could actually drill a worker down. And then there's a photon cannon down there that is neutral and unpowered that you have to kill before you can expand. And that's just like a nerf deterrent so that you can't just float
wish,
a command.
If I could just gripe for a second, I wish we didn't have like eggs and cannons as the thing that's like there because it's so confusing for new players. But yeah, they use these assets that are normally in the game to basically make obstructions so you can kill. So that if you kill it, you get it. It makes the whole flow of the game more interesting.
Yeah. It's really ingenious design. The map designers in StarCraft 1 are fantastic. Except whoever made Fighting Spirit. That person should fall down a cliff. But it was good in its day. But this is a cool two-player map, man. Like, I'm excited to see just how this one plays out and how it feels.
Yeah, it should be fun. Again, Shuttle playing remotely here. You know, we'll see how he performs. He did not play well in that last game.
Yeah. You know, he should have had barracks. He should have won that game.
If he was playing like 10% better, I think he closes it out. I mean, that's the scary thing about a guy like barracks. Gamo, I don't think we're going to have a lurker contain here, but we did have a crazy lurk contain last season that was a lot of fun to follow. And so, anyways, I mean, we're ready.
He's really good at Hydra Lurk, actually.
He's
now
crazy.
That you bring that up, I'm remembering that game.
Yeah.
He's very good at that.
All right, guys, let's go. Loser's match. Let's eliminate one of these players.
Right. In the top right, we have Shuttle. And bottom left, we have Gamo. I'm excited about this map, to be perfectly honest with you, Tasteless. It looks cool. You got that kind of low ground no man's land in the center. You got, what is this, 6 bases on each side.
Yeah.
Some really interesting terrain changes. You have that very interesting back base where it's like, oh, do you want to send multiple workers back there or something to try to kill off that cannon quickly? It looks neat.
Yeah, it's going to be fun to see what kind of games this makes on a map like this. To be honest, I look at this map and I'm like not sure what to make of it. I feel like there's enough variables that, like, I don't want to say anything definitively. Clearly, you can expand on this map, or Shuttle wouldn't be doing it. It does seem like all modern maps are designed with the Protoss needing to expand in mind. That does appear to be, in this matchup, by the way, that does appear to be, like, an absolute necessity in any kind of modern map, is to give Protoss that option.
Yeah, I definitely think you're right about that. Like, I think that that's actually across all the races. Like, you can't really one base in StarCraft anymore. If you do, it's like a crazy risk.
Yeah, if you
right?
do, it's like a very exceptional build. And it's not really like a build that you bring out several times in a row in most of these matchups.
Mm-hmm.
We've got a very early pool here from Gamo.
Yeah, and you see the double gas, which, by the way, I had actually missed. I was so busy focused on that back natural area, but that's really interesting. I actually wonder exactly how much is in there. You know that those are not 5,000 guys.
Yeah, usually they have one that's got, you know, like 1,000 or 1,500 or something in there.
Yeah. It's probably the top one is 4 and the bottom one's 1 for thousands. So, like, that's normally how the double gas in main goes, so that you still have, you know, the 5,000 total that you get very quickly, but now you can get it more quickly, right? For three minutes and 20 seconds, you can mine at full double.
Is he got a pylon block here? No.
Just a little bit of... A little bit of block in there, and he did get the forge, of course, from this nice quick scout, so it doesn't seem like any Zergling pressure is going to be able to do anything from Gamo.
It does appear that this is a map you could cannon rush behind the minerals, by the way. Not a factor here, of course, but just something to point out. This is probably why Zerg goes for pool right away, is just so that that's not a thing.
Yeah, that makes sense. It's funny to watch Protosses figure out, like, cannon rush locations on new maps and see that pop up for a little bit. Like, we saw, like, a lot of cannon rushes on Butter for, like, the first month.
Yeah.
And then it kind of goes away.
Yeah, they sort of go away after a while. Like, each map, when you cannon rush, there's, like, certain things you want to watch for because, you know, the AI pathing is so finicky depending on how the map is structured that, like, there's all these little rules you got to learn to master. So cannon rushes tend to be popular at the start, and they kind of dry up.
Well, the probe trying to get some more scouting info. The third base has been taken from Gamo up to the north there. Looks like the probe is going to go around that way and give that a little look-see, see exactly what Gamo's up to. Well, not exactly. You can't get into the main, so doesn't know for sure, you know, if there's something like a three-hatch Hydra. And that's what Gamo is trying to hide here, is whether he's going lair or den.
So... we don't know what Protoss really wants to do yet until the core is done, so we're basically waiting and watching for that. I do want to point out, if you have three gases like you do here, even though the total gas that you're going to get in the game is the same because you can get a little bit of gas more quickly, I think this does allow for some stronger two-base pushes against the Zerg.
Mm-mm.
You know,
That's a really good point, actually. Uh-huh. Like, you got to look at these matchups and see, like, what does that double geyser, even if it's momentary, what does it do? And you're definitely right. Like, Psystorm, you can get out a lot more easily, can't you?
Well, it's not just that. You can get Psystorm upgrades at the Forge and the Robo and the Dragoon Range and the Zealot Speed all out a little bit quicker, right? You know, this matchup for the Protoss, it's like the gas is so disproportionately important compared to the other resources in the game, that, like, when you're playing this from the Protoss's perspective, like, obviously you're trying to be careful with your minerals, but, like, every gas decision as far as tech that you go for, it's, like, huge, man. And so having the third gas, and look, this may or may not be a factor, I don't know, this map is fresh out of the oven, right? Like, we're gonna see a lot of pretty interesting games on this. By the way, this is a Hydra bust, but just to finish my thought, you know, this does appear to be a map that, as a Protoss player, you could power up on two bases and be even stronger than you normally are when you power up to 8 gates and push. Like, you'd probably have, like, the Observer speed and, like, 2 more Templars and, you know, maybe run an extra Forge here. I think, I don't know the math on this perfectly, but I think everybody gets what I'm saying. So he's going to spot the Hydras here. And this is much less about the Protoss's mid-game and more about the Zerg and Protoss's early game here, because this attack's going to come out very quickly, intending to tear down the entrance.
And this Corsair actually pushing back some of the Overlords here that are seemingly in position maybe to stop any DTs coming out to help against his Hydra push. But already we have those cannons started. Like, it did shuttle scout this quickly enough that he's going to be able to just hold it easily.
It's a good question. The cannons are right up by the gates, which is not necessarily bad if he has enough there. Oh my god, he's going to do it again, dude. He really likes to do this. This is so cool. So, keep in mind, we talked about this being a Hydra bust. I don't know that it's that as much anymore. This is actually a different setup for a contain here. So from the Protoss's perspective, there's a reason why the Observer was blocking the vision here for the Protoss. It looks like this is an all-in, right? So you're basically just making cannons, but he's not committed to tearing this down. He may tech to a lair and just make Lurker sunk and try to entomb the Protoss into his two bases.
I love this idea. Like, yeah. This is super cool. And this is such an old way to play. I remember seeing people do back in, like, 2005 and stuff. He finally scouts exactly what he's up against. Now, do you want to go Reaver against this? Like, is that the way?
I mean, there's a lot of, I think, healthy ideas about going for Reaver, right? I mean, a Reaver can shoot down the Hydras. I think the problem is that I think the Reaver doesn't fare as well as you might expect. I think he actually was making a Robo in his main, so the answer might be yes, but I just want to make it clear, like, the Reaver's not as obvious of an answer as you might think it is, right? So he's got the Reaver tech. He may try to shuttle out a DT here outside of main and try to kill stuff. That's another good thing to do when this happens. Gamo's been pretty neglectful of his overlords here. Like, he's barely got defense, but...
Yeah.
You know, the problem is that, like, you know, on paper, the Reaver makes sense. It doesn't do as well against a wall of Sunken Colonies and Hydras. You know, it's the same reason why we don't early game see a Reaver really bust an early game Zerg, right?
Yeah. Yeah, no, it's actually really hard for the Reaver to attack into Static D. It's, like, not very good at busting things.
Yeah, like, it's a surprisingly buggy unit. It looks, like, amazing when you're fighting it, but then when it's trying to do weird stuff, like either shoot up ramps or, like, sometimes try to hit Sunken Colonies or cannons, it'll bug out.
Yeah, I've definitely noticed when Reavers are attacking Sunkens to the south, they will always walk into range of the Sunken. Like, you have to be very careful about how to set it up. It's kind of like Guardians. Like, if you right-click a Guardian into, like, a turret... It oftentimes just floats right into it.
Right.
So the DT is out here actually doing a bit of harassment. And so that's doing a fantastic job. Now, Sunkens actually outrange cannons by half, half of a pixel or whatever, right? Am I crazy here?
Sorry,
don't they just slightly outrange?
Sorry, what?
If I'm recalling this correctly, don't Sunkens outrange cannons?
Yeah, just barely,
like, half
at
a
certain
matrix.
Angles.
Yeah. Yeah.
But it's not an ideal pairing. It's not like, you know, a tank and a cannon or something. You know what I mean? Where it's like you're always going to easily be outranging it. And so as Sunken pushing is not really what the goal is here. The goal is to contain. Now let's watch the Reaver and see if the difficulty of this is illustrated here.
So a Sunken is like 300 health, right?
Wow, so he already snipes. Oh, I'm sorry. I'm crazy. I, for some reason, thought I heard the Reaver die. I don't know. That's COVID, man. I'm getting Reaver sound effects that don't happen in the game here.
Yeah. That's listed as one of the side effects.
Yeah, it's one
actually.
Of the side effects, dude. I'm like, no, Artosis, that's the vaccine. No. Now, he's going to come in here. He's going to try to do some damage to that. And, you know, it's a slog, man. It's a long uphill fight to try to tear down this. Now, I do want to point out, if he actually breaks this open, the Zerg just dies. Okay? There's no ifs, ands, or buts about that. It's a very straightforward.
It seems he's going to. He has two more Reavers coming down right now. He's playing fantastically, right?
Well,
like, he's done so much harassment with a DT and two Corsairs at this point as well.
I mean... Here's the thing, like, there's so much creep that you can keep putting Sunken Colonies in. It's kind of this weird thing, you know, this creep spreads out so much that you do have a lot of room to keep making Sunks. I will say he's doing a good job. Like, I'm impressed. The problem is going to be when Lurkers come into play here and Aspire finishes. Now, normally we don't see the hatch contain come up this fast because you already have Lurker tech when you do this, which is why the Reavers, I think, have been effective so far. But when Scourge come up, Hydra speed, which is already here, by the way, with range, and Observers have to be here, that's when the Protoss gets strained quite considerably. And so
the Lurkers are out, and they're being spread around, but he's broken most of the Sunkens.
Yeah, but until an Observer gets here, he can just remake the Sunks. I mean, Sunks come very fast, right? This is one of the most frustrating things to play against is Protoss, actually. Nice.
Immediately kills off that one. Very nice hit. Yeah, it looks like the Lurkers are starting to be a little bit annoying. He does have double Robo, so the Observers start to come out. Be interesting to see if he gets both the Observer upgrades. I think that might be a very smart situation to do it.
I think so. I think you want to have the range first. Although I see a lot of people get speed. But I feel like the range, you can kind of, especially with cannons here, you can kind of scoot it back into the cannons if you need to.
Yeah, yeah. That is a lot of high Templars out as well. That's a very technical army. I feel like I'm watching the Defense of Ire or something right now.
So he just dives on these two Reavers. He gets one. By the way, the cherry on top in this position is to get one Spore. And that's when it, I really feel like the Protoss just, you know, it's a nightmare to try to get out of here because the Spore's range is hilarious. And we may
Dude,
see
machine guns too. The Spore is a ridiculous anti-air ability.
Yeah, it's so powerful and fires so fast. It has such range. It's so much better than like every other defensive building in the game.
Yeah, it really is. By the way, he did get Reaver damage upgrade, so he's doing 125 per shot. Oh, another Observer gets picked off. That's why you got to get those Observer upgrades, man.
Yep, you're 100% right about that. So he's mustered enough Dragoons. Let's see if he can do the push here. It's a lot of it's going to come down to the obs, but I think you might be right, Artosis. I think he's kind of hacked and sawed his way through here. Now, Sunken Lurker, I mean, a lot of times this is how Protoss lose, just attacking into a base that looks like this, right? keep in mind the main is going to dry up. The natural's not looking too pretty as far as minerals go. So
he should be able to take that back expand eventually. I'm not sure if those temples actually ever got killed. I did see some Hydras go up there earlier, but here we go. Going forward once again after these Reavers. But there are Psy Storms here that could support. He picks off all three Reavers, though, and now backs up. I mean, this has not been cost efficient. He's down half supply from where Shuttle's at, but Shuttle decides, let's go right now. Throwing some Psy Storms down onto these Lurkers, and that is a lot of Dragoons.
Yeah, and this may be the right number. You know, again, if he can just kind of chew his way through this, I think he can do it. And there are, I think, barely enough Dragoons. If he kind of positions this right and keeps manufacturing, I think he can bust out. And again, if he busts out, the Zerg loses. I mean, there's nothing else you can do. Getting the hatch is a big win here, too, by the way. Oh, that Dragoon, what a nightmare. It's blocking the entrance.
Oh, that's terrible. I was wondering where the rest of his army was. More Hydras coming up right now. Looks like that Dragoon finally going to make its way down, and with it, the rest of the reinforcing army. Psy Storms on the incoming Hydras. Look at this supply of Gamo, man. Kind of a crazy game out of him. No real fallback at this point. He is doubled in supply.
I mean, the whole investment here. By the way, I'm kind of weirded out he did this when there is like a free base in the back. You know what I mean? I feel like this is the one map you wouldn't want to do this on, but... Yeah, I mean, the supply is so low because Gamo has invested literally everything he's had into trying to cage the Protoss in.
And now he's going after those temples, so it looks like he wants to maybe attack the third base that's going to be taken by Shuttle, but it feels like Shuttle has an army that can walk across the map and kill him now.
Okay, so, I mean, I'm pretty confident that this is over. I mean... You know, this is a three-base Zerg that has no army, has probably lost more drones that were turned into sunken colonies than he had made that mined this whole game. I mean, there's just such an insane, an investment that did not pay off, right?
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, this is actually one of the older strats in the game that Zergs used to do. And, you know, we don't really see it in ASL, and we have it in years, except when Gamo plays. And it was kind of funny. We talked about Lurker Sunk Contain, and maybe he's going to do that. And it's always kind of fun when we actually get that right. But, yeah, here we are again. The problem now is, I mean, the Protoss has an extremely powerful, now three-base. It was two-base army with Shuttle Reaver, all the right upgrades, right, against, you know, a pretty stale layer tech here. And so, yeah, I mean, this is over. This base is going to fall. Gamo's going to be the first player knocked out of Group B.
Yeah, and it's unfortunate. I mean, he is a very good player. That was a very scary situation. But I agree with you that this seems like it might be the worst map for that, especially with the three gas. It's like he went Shuttle Speed, Reavers off two Robos, plenty of Observers, Psy Storm, Reaver damage. You know, he got everything, and it wasn't hard for him because he has three gases.
So he made Mutas here too, which is I mean, it's kind of sad to watch, right? Like, this isn't going to do anything. I really enjoyed this game, man. This was a, you know, a very different one. I think this is one of the games that, even though it's different, and, like, I definitely wouldn't try what the Zerg did, it kind of shows, you know, why the game usually has a certain rhythm, even if Zerg wants to do this. You don't get the hatchery before you have the layer. You know, the hatchery contained before you have the layer. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, totally. Well, he was not in any position to stop those Reavers, it seemed.
No.
Like, he picked a few of them off here and there, but it was so cost inefficient. Now the, he comes out, he picks off a lot of the splash damage with these Mutas, but there's not enough Hydras to kill off everything else anyways.
Yeah, I mean, the Dragoons alone win the fight, right? GG. Mm-hmm. That's it. We have our first player eliminated. And this leaves Shuttle and Barracks going at it again, the rematch, dude.
Yeah, I'm not too surprised that this is going to be our final match of the night. Gamo going out first again. You know, the tiers that they have assigned are basically staying true. Gamo is a strong player. He's in just about every ASL, but this is what happens to him, right? He just he can't. I think, wasn't it last season he did advance? Like, he knocked someone really good out, but... Shuttle is definitely a little bit better there. And even though it doesn't seem like he's playing his absolute best, I think he can still advance here against Barracks.
Yeah, I think he's got a really good shot. It's going to be a fun rematch. Gamo, look, dude, I always love casting this guy's game. I think you can see why he's a scary opponent, but not cut for the next stage of ASL. Guys, up next, the final match of Group B. You don't want to miss it. We will be right back. Welcome back, everyone. This is it. Group B is about to end. We've got the rematch of Shuttle versus Barracks. This is going to be interesting. Shuttle, it seemed like he was in a winning position, but Barracks fought back and got a really good setup, recontained Shuttle. Shuttle, you know, we don't review these VODs before we cast them. You know, we cast them as if they're live, and, like, it was a weird game. It seemed like Shuttle might have been able to break him with his shuttles. But then, I don't know, it was just a bad fight. So Barracks closed it out. Mm-hmm. We're going to be going on to Nemesis, the Gothic Windmill map.
Dude, yeah, this is cool, man. There's a lot going on this map. It reminds me a lot of, suddenly the map name is out of my brain. But we had a map that looked very similar to this before. And basically what you see here, some of the main parts are, for instance, there's a disruption web that's on in the middle, so that's just, I think, a stylistic
point. That's the belly button of the map, so.
Yeah. The assimilators. So there's eggs there. The eggs obviously have very high armor. They're hard to kill early, but you can drill through those to go to these expansions. And if you kill the assimilators, basically assimilators are smaller than geysers.
Yeah.
Once you kill those, it becomes impassable. No units can walk between two geysers
anything
can walk through. Yes, exactly. So you could literally make those island-ish bases. So there's, like, a lot of play that goes on with that. And there's a lot of things you can do, like take past expansions over there. Obviously, you can get all sorts of drop play or air play that can get in there. It's a really fascinating type of map, this type of map. And we've had a few that have looked like this in the past.
Yeah, this especially when it's, you know, brand new like this, you can see a lot of strategies that are going to be really unique and original. You know, in PvT as well, there's a lot of, you know, this is already a fun matchup. There's a lot of creative things both races can do to each other. So yeah, I mean, I'm just kind of waiting to see what exactly they're going to do. You know, I would not be shocked if Shuttle tries to use one of these locations that's hard to get access to on the ground and maybe make a proxy robo. It's possible for Barracks to hide factories there and do a factory float. I don't know. A lot can happen here. We're ready. Yeah. Nemesis, final game. Shuttle versus Barracks. Let's see who survives and who gets knocked out.
Have a Shuttle in the bottom right there, and in the top left we have Barracks. So yeah, I don't know why I can't remember the name of this map right now, but we had a map that looked very much like this, and but this looks to be like a slightly updated version. Like I like the geysers on the outside, so that you actually have a way from the middle of the map to attack into there, because that was the big problem with the map before.
Right.
And obviously we have some other terrain features in the center as well. It looks like we have like multiple high to low ground terrain shifts and all that. But what we were seeing a lot on this map previously was Protoss kind of taking some of these fringe bases and utilizing, you know, the strong shuttle play can kind of defend it, kind of harass the Terran a little bit. And carriers were very, very popular on the last map that looked kind of like this. So I'm wondering if that's something that we'll end up seeing here out of Shuttle.
Yeah, let's see what happens. You know, I'm always kind of wiggly when we get a map like this, you know, right out of the gate, because sometimes we get one of those games that's a one-of-a-kind, super memorable game. I am, by the way, glad that we backed away from stupid island maps. There was a period where Afrika TV had lost its mind, and it's like, what about the dumbest island map? Like,
yeah,
and it's so much better to just have these, like, you know, quality, creative ground maps. And I'm not anti-island map either, by the way. But I mean, there was a point where it was getting so eccentric what we were doing, and I'm like, well, this isn't even like what people watch when they watch StarCraft, you know?
Yeah, well, I mean, it was fun for like a little bit, but when I'm, you know, like Sparkle, I think, is one of the ones that you're thinking about right now. Sparkle was, it literally had like a 0% Terran win rate. Like,
oh, it was so bad.
Crazy. Like, it was so unplayable. That one was insane. And then we had that Inner Coven map, which was insane. But we actually had a few good games on that one, at least.
Oh, for sure. But I just feel like when we have a Star League like this, I'm like, is this really what we're going to use as, you know, the measurement of who's going to be the best here?
Yeah, I know what you mean for sure. Well, this probe actually gets out there pretty quickly, and we'll do a little bit of harassment here. The factory gets down super fast, though, here from Barracks. And the probe not going to be able to stay for too long. SCV comes up, actually sees the Zealot leaving the base, so that's very useful for Barracks. And I hadn't realized this, but it looks like this is different level terrain than the natural, isn't it? He's like, these are low ground mains.
That's right. They are low ground mains.
Yeah.
And so it's kind of like, ooh. God, we're so bad with map names. Was it Gladiator? Was that the map or Gauntlet?
Yeah. Gladiator is the low ground
right.
Main base that I think you're probably.
Like Garden Shed?
Right,
what is
now
the name of that map? Like. Gladiator. Yeah. So, you know, one thing about this, or I guess a more classic map would be Reverse Lost Temple, which I thought was actually a pretty fun map to have for a little while here. But on maps like this, you got to be careful, because if you do get contained in pretty much all the matchups, it's hard to fight up ramps. Also, there's eggs on the ramps, and sometimes eggs make things a little bit more difficult. They're a little bit buggier.
Yeah. So definitely making sure that you have control of your natural base area is so, so important. Ooh, just gets it out of there. Actually, very important to keep that SCV alive. That's going to let him know if anything comes through trying to make a new base or anything like that. And it seems like Barracks... Oh, Barracks is actually attacking across the map right now. Look at this. He's going for like 6 Marine, 2 Vulture. If they skip range completely, you can sometimes do something with this.
Yeah.
But the probe just saw it incoming, so I'm not sure how much he'll actually end up getting
done. I think
a
battery stops this, by the way.
Oh, yeah, battery helps so much
battery,
if you have it against
it's
this.
Funny. Like, it's... Okay, here we go. Good block
that
here with the
a hero. Yeah,
his death was not in vain there. The next set of reinforcements is going to come. Now, we want to watch that Dragoon pretty carefully. The hull was damaged.
Yeah, some probes coming up right now. He's going to go ahead and target down the Vultures as quickly as possible. Yes. They are kind of the dangerous unit. Ooh, nice pickoff there. The probes coming out to fight. Poor Shuttleman. He's having to fight with probes against these early pushes from Barracks. Some great targeting down on the probes. And I got to say, like, those early units don't really matter that much for Terran, so that was nice. But his command center only just started. So even though that, like, in some ways looked good, the two Nexuses, like, he's got 75-second head start on his second Nexus, which will refill those probes easily.
Yeah, and when you see Vultures like this, you know there's no tank, so these Dragoons coming across are a real threat. Now, that mine, that's pretty good.
That's
awesome.
He's
going to have to eat that, yeah.
They will be able to get up there. Oh, the mine's here, though. The mine's here. Oh,
what?
God.
Yeah, I was going to say.
Well...
Well, hold on a second. You know, a Dragoon could do quite a lot on its own.
Mm.
Yeah, you could easily win the fight against the Marine. The thing is, two Dragoons is so much better than one because you can do that micro tactic where you gun down the mine.
Mm-hmm. Well, here, this is such a wild opener from Barracks. Mm-hmm. I haven't seen anything quite like this. Like, to attack across map and do that well, It actually reminds me of the last game that we saw him against Shuttle, right? Where he actually way overmade Marines from what we're used to. It feels like he has found, like, these little chinks in the Protoss early game where some extra Marines actually do a fantastic job. And, I mean, both games we're seeing that. And now suddenly he's going to set up a Vulture drop as well.
Yeah, the Vulture drop's going to be interesting. I don't feel like Shuttle's going to be that prepared. I think, you know, it's very tempting when you don't see tanks to try to lean in. But if you don't see tanks, usually it does mean there's a dropship coming, right? I mean, Terrans don't just sit in their base and make Vultures and you know, cross their fingers. So, you know, the fact that he's not, it doesn't appear at least, he's not prepared for this. This could be, like, huge damage coming in here. Let's see if the Observer and the dropship cross paths.
Oh, they might just barely. Okay, did Shuttle see that, though?
Well, that was on,
that's the big question.
That was on the minimap for a while here. He sees it. He's pulling back.
Yeah, it looks that way. And, of course, back at home, Shuttle has, or Barracks has a bunker up. He has a siege tank up, so he's going to be fine there. Let's see how well Shuttle can actually block this. Okay, he kills one Vulture immediately with those 6 shots. Oh,
my
goes
God.
After the second.
Oh, my. What?
Oh, God. Yeah, okay, that's what I thought would happen, but... Shuttle almost having a miraculous hold right there, but definitely some probe damage occurring.
All right, he doesn't have another mine to plant here, but, you know, I think the drop went very well. I think he did a good job there.
Yeah.
By the way, there's a Nexus being taken here at 3 o'clock. We see it right now. And we don't see the definitive tech path here. He is going to get a Robo, but that's kind of a, you know, it doesn't... telegraph the late game intentions here.
Yeah, it seems like the Reaver tech just, it makes sense. Like, you kind of need speed shuttles. You want the Reaver out there anyways.
Right.
Because, you know, there are so many bases that are on the fringe here. And speed shuttles are just, like, better than dropships. So you can really kind of tax Terran's defense with play like that on a map like this.
Okay, so this drop's coming in here. And, you know, one of the things about when Protoss is wall their mains in like this is that's great unless they drop inside the wall in. I guess he's actually not completely walled in, though, right? He's got access. I retract that statement. But another nice drop in here. He's going to get a couple more workers. Only 2, I guess. Not as much as he probably needed.
Yeah, the dropship lived, so at least there's that. It looks like he is getting ready to take his own base here. and going to go up and start removing some of those eggs as well. But I'm excited to see Shuttle kind of running around with some speed shuttles at this point,
yeah.
right? Because that's where it's going to get really strong. Now, what do you think? Do you think he's making a Wraith right now? Or do you think he's going like for more dropships? Because that would be wild. I think the Wraith makes a lot of sense.
I think the Wraith is better. I mean, I think, you know, when you start to see Wraiths, you're a lot less cavalier with your Shuttle and Reaver. And so I would assume it's a Wraith. I have seen some games where people are getting a couple Wraiths. I don't know if that's good or not. It does seem like this is a thing that pops up every once in a while where we see like a couple Wraiths made. Again, this is a kind of a semi-island map, if you will. So sometimes Wraiths can actually be pretty handy, especially against speed shuttles.
They can be pretty decent. Yeah, there is a single Wraith already. We'll see if he makes more. Actually, I don't know if you've seen this, Tasis, but occasionally we're getting Valkyries against speed shuttles.
Oh, that's... I did not know that. I would welcome that very much.
Yeah, I saw Light do it. I've used it a little bit. It's pretty neat if they go mass speed shuttle. It's actually very good at clearing them. But here comes that Wraith now, and the shuttle does have its speed upgrade. It's going to try to get out of here. Does he have a Dragoon in there? Oh, he doesn't? Oh, it was Zealots!
Well, no, that's the thing is, if you go speed shuttle, you're not putting Dragoons in the shuttle, right? They're too big. So it's almost always Reavers and... oh, nice. It's almost always Reavers and Zealots, because they just sort of complement the size of the load in the shuttle. So, I mean, big pickoff there.
That is. That's a really big deal. The fact that he got that first speed shuttle without really taking damage is really fantastic. Second Robo on the way. I love it. I think for this map, this is great to see the double Robo play.
Yeah, this is probably going to be a pretty long and epic game. If you look at this from the Terran's perspective, do you fear Arbiter Recall or Carrier more?
Oh, Carrier, by far. Like, I mean, Arbiter Recall would be good here. Definitely nothing wrong with that. But Carriers, like, the way that they can... Like, for instance, he could attack this base, and you'd have to walk Goliaths up there, and then he could just walk out, right? Like, he can just fly out, like, 2 centimeters, and you can't hit it with your Goliaths. So if he gets a lot of Carriers, you're just not going to win. So I think that that's going to be one of the main things that Barracks has to keep his eyes on if he thinks that there might be a Carrier switch at some point. But when you go double Robo like this, I think, like, you can't really go Carrier. You're spending a lot of money on the double Robo.
No, this is sort of the third late-game tech, I guess, that now exists in the matchup. And it's always sort of been present, but Speed Shuttle in mass with Reavers and or Storm is another totally appropriate way to play the game. And it's a way to play the game where you win the fight head-on.
Yeah, you're looking... It's really good at scuffling. It's really good at harassing. I think it's hard with this type of play to actually kill Terran. I think that if Terran kind of stays turtled, you don't have a whole lot of things that you can do against it. And generally, like, if it starts going very late with this style, you generally go into Arbiter, not Carrier. It fits way better with Arbiter.
Yeah, well, if you... Especially with a double Robo, you will sometimes have just, like, a little bit of extra gas. And an Arbiter is always... Even just one is always kind of a good thing to have. Sometimes that's, like, the skeleton key to unlock the problem that Protoss might have on the map, you know? Mm-hmm. Where it's like, well, I gotta get him out of this position if I could just recall there. Or maybe if I could just stasis this one thing, you know?
Yeah, for sure. Now, some little scuffles going on. He utilized a dropship and some speed vultures to get over here and try to attack this base. It looks like Shuttle will be able to clean it up. At the same time here, we have 3 speed shuttles, or 4 now, ready to dive in. There's a lot of defense here, but this should clear the base, I think.
Oh, this is going to completely, excuse me, completely wreck the base, for sure. I mean, are these not speed cells?
No, not yet.
I think the upgrade might have closed out
right there.
It just finished. Okay. But tons of damage dealt over there. And, it does seem like this is kind of the way to do it. Yeah, just go mass speed shuttle. Neither Protoss or Terran, how do I say this? They're okay at using dropships and shuttles to get stuff places, but you need things in mass to do it. But with the double Robo, I mean, he could just rinse and repeat over and over again, right? And, I mean, how are you ever going to push out as Terran on the map if you keep losing this position over and over, right?
Yeah, that's the problem. You do have to have a bit more defense there, right? So, like, more turrets, more mines, that type of thing, I think, is going to be the right type of play. And look at this. He just comes right back in before that turret's finished. But with the Wraith there, this is a one-way mission.
Yeah. With top right being taken, the supply is fairly even. The shuttle's no doubt being renewed. It does seem like we've got a lot more time on the clock for Terran before they can really become active, right?
Yeah, yeah. Like, he needs to kind of stabilize that base. And honestly, I think he needs to set up a fourth before he goes out. And how do you do that against the mass speed shuttles? That's going to be one of the trickier questions, I think. In fact, I want to see him move into the center maybe and kill the eggs that lead up to 12 o'clock.
Mm.
So that he can actually go in there and clean up shuttle play, because otherwise, I don't know how you would ever defend both these bases.
Okay, we're gonna have that first real engage. Terran pushing out a little bit quicker than I expected. Now we've watched Zealots and Reavers in the fights, but really what we want to watch for is a Psystorm. Now, one thing about Mass Storm against Terran is kind of hard to pull off. As far as getting all the storms, like sometimes you almost have like an excess of Templars because like it's not easy to get. You know, the Templar Storm, it's pretty ideal against Zerg, and it turns out to be pretty awful against Terran. You know, it's like tanks can shoot everything down. So we want to watch basically and see, okay, how do the storms actually pair up here against what Terran has?
Yeah, well, it's all about trying to... If Terran pushes too quickly, they're clumped, and the storms absolutely destroy.
Yeah, exactly.
If Terran's in an entrenched position spread, the storms do very, very little.
Yeah.
So you have to kind of balance that on both sides, right? So he needs to push quickly, but not too quickly.
So Terran's now in the middle. Now, this is... We should point out this middle of the map, it's actually high ground, low ground, high ground, low ground.
Mm-hmm.
So the tiles are the high ground. Now, this is a pretty stuffy spot here, but a pretty bad attack overall. And see how that Templar got shot down? It's kind of hard when you spam everything out to get the storms off where you need. Now, you want ideally the storms to land on the tanks, but you take what you can get. A vulture is an acceptable or group. There it is. That's what you want to be hitting. Because the storm doesn't care about
those are really
armor.
Good storms.
Yep.
No, it does not. And now he does hit good storms, but they're late. If he had hit those at the beginning of the fight, this Terran army would already be dead. But instead, shuttle is way down in supply right now.
So the tanks are going to come down a little bit closer. I'm worried that Barracks is slowly moving into the jaws of the beast here. He's sending reinforcements, but these tanks are getting kind of squishy. That being said, I don't see Dragoons with this. Zealots alone are not actually that good. Now, there's a mine right in the middle of this. Well, he spreads away from that pretty nicely.
Mm. Yeah, decent storm in there as well, but you're right. Like, pure Zealot is not going to do it. The Vulture rally that comes up across the map, like, you know you're just going to see a lot of Vultures coming across. Another good storm, though. The tanks are certainly getting very low, but is he going to get the critical mass he needs to actually break through this Terran army?
Well, this might be enough for Protoss here. We're going to see a lot of these tanks should be pretty softened up here, so they're going to be popped like balloons when they actually start to take damage. But there's a big wave of Terran coming here. It's going to be meeting up with the rest of this. Two tanks and a bunch of Vultures. I mean, he needs to kill this DT, but assuming that does get killed, there it is. You know, he might get a
that's
pretty
a
good
lot
position
of,
here.
A lot of Vultures coming up now as well. A dropship did go into the main base. I think we actually have a couple Vultures in there wreaking havoc. And, you know, Shuttle still has a good economy. It's a better economy than what Barracks has. But this is reminding me a lot of the Butter game, where Barracks is actually a little bit behind, does one really big push, and suddenly he's in front of the production. And now Shuttle, it's Shuttle's problem to deal with.
Okay, so, I mean, it's funny. This is like the sequel, really, to that first game they played. It's going to be, once again, the Terran containing the Protoss where the production facilities are. This will really come down to whether or not, you know, Protoss can break free because he's shackled in here. And, I mean, this is almost becoming too much to deal with. This is a maxed out Terran, by the way.
Mm-hmm.
Now, that being said, it's kind of hard to fork off your army and take out these bases. normally when we see this position set up, we see like three tanks at each other base shelling the Nexuses. And if you know, Protoss cannot break free and stop, you know, the progress that's been had over there, well, it's just a tough game from there, right?
Well, he's going to go ahead and try to bust now. The Reavers not getting the shots that they really needed. The Zealots being cleaned up by so many Vultures that have been rallied down at this point. Barrack's macro just completely on point. And it seems like he's going to be able to finish him. Oh, absolutely brutal. Like another very strong three-base attack here from Barrack's.
So, oh, he's mined out over there. He needs to transfer those. Keep in mind, this Terran's on three bases. It's easy to kind of lose focus of the big picture here. You know, three bases is not ideal. A fourth would be nice. But I think at this point in time, we're about to see Shuttle tap out here. We talked about this at the start of the game, but you start out on low ground here. Imagine a maxed out Terran army when you're on low ground trying to get up this little ramp.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, you're just...
You literally never... You will never, yeah, ever, ever
that's a life sentence
there.
To your main base. GG.
And that's it. Yeah. Barrack's does end up advancing. I think he played well. There was some great moves that he made, and he was very decisive with the attacks both times against Shuttle. But I do wonder if Shuttle, you know, was... If he was playing his best, does Barrack's advance here? And I feel like the answer is no. Like, it did feel like both games, Shuttle was in good enough positions that he could have ended up winning and just couldn't quite execute the busts.
Yeah, I agree, man. I think that, you know, Shuttle, you know, playing from home, maybe his condition not great today. Maybe still feeling ill. I mean, you know, it's... He didn't play his best, but I think Barrack's really outperformed here. And props to him, man. He's going on to the next stage.
Yeah, and I mean, I'd love to see it. Our first Terran that's going to advance to the next round. And Barrack's is a fun one to watch. He's definitely on the cutting edge as far as build orders go. I really enjoyed his early game both times, like this heavy Marine pressure into the Vulture drop. Like, that was cool. That was cool. And I want to see more fresh ideas like that.
Me too, for sure. And again, we got to see how far Barrack's can go, but looking like a real threat here.
스탠포드 24강 비조 경기 모두 만나보셨습니다. 오늘의 두 번째 진출자 테란 황병영 선수와 함께하겠습니다. 축하드립니다. 고생 많으셨습니다.
감사합니다.
경기가 끝나고 나서 약간은 안도하는 듯한 표정을 제가 봤거든요. 쉽지 않은 경기들을 승리하고 또 16강에 진출하셨습니다. 지난 시즌의 패배가 또 좋은 약으로 돌아온 것 같은데요. 진출 소감 어떠신가요?
제가 생각보다 멘탈이 좀 안 좋아가지고 시즌마다 좀 진짜 안 좋은 경기력 많이 보여드렸는데 오늘 진짜 열심히 연습했는데 이게 좀 그래도 조금 보여드린 것 같아서 다행인 것 같아요.
오늘 김윤중 선수와 두 번의 경기가 있었습니다. 두 번 모두 초반에 굉장히 공격적으로 좀 풀어나가시는 모습이 있었는데 첫 번째 김윤중 선수와의 경기에서는 이 3탱크 타이밍에 좀 거세게 흔드는 듯한 모습이 있었는데 김윤중 선수가 막아냈거든요. 사실 그때 끝내고자 하는 마음도 있었나요?
아, 그때 무조건 끝냈어야 되는데 제가 또 긴장해가지고 조금 실수를 했어요. 그래가지고 아, 망했다. 또 망했구나 했는데 중간중간에 그냥 연습을 많이 했다 보니까 그냥 맞아, 한 대로만 연습하자, 게임하자 하는데 손이 너무 그래도 중간부터는 잘 움직여가지고 그래서 승리할 수 있었던 것 같아요.
뭔가 경기가 초반에 황병영 선수가 그렸던 그림대로는 풀려나가지 않았던 것 같지만 뒷심을 강력하게 발휘해주는 모습이 굉장히 인상적이었습니다. 이런 단단한 메카닉 운영, 김윤중 선수의 두 번째 경기에서도 좀 돋보였는데요. 어떤 전투가 좀 가장 승리 요인이었다고 생각하세요?
일단 컨셉이 그 이제 토스도 이제 그 드랍식 같은 거 맞기가 굉장히 힘든 맵이라고 생각을 했어요. 그래서 드랍식으로 좀 흔들고 9시 이제 멀티에 이제 벙커를 일부러 지어놓고 이제 한번 받기를 기다렸어요. 그래서 받고 바로 나간다는 마인드로 2일업 원래 타이밍을 준비를 해가지고 적절하게 잘 싸워가지고 잘 된 것 같아요.
네, 또 센터에서 병력으로 승리를 거두고 끝내는 모습이 있었는데 얘기를 들어보니까 네메시스를 좀 좋아하셨다고 연습 때 들었거든요.
네, 그러니까 원래 진짜 토스전 빡세다고 다들 그랬는데 저는 승률이 좀 많이 좋았어요. 오. 그래서 저랑 좀 잘 맞는 맵인 것 같아가지고
오~
그래서 괜찮더라고요 생각보다 그래서 자신 있었어요.
황병영 선수가 오늘 본인의 스타일을 또 한 번 좀 보여주는 그런 경기들이 나왔습니다. 저번 시즌에는 24강에서 좀 탈락을 하고 이번 시즌에는 다시 한번 16강에 복귀를 하셨는데요. 앞으로의 각오가 어떠신가요?
일단 근데 연습 도와준 사람들이 진짜 많아요.
네.
다 부탁해가지고
다 한 분 한 분 말씀해 주세요. 네.
너무 고마워가지고.
네.
그 현재랑 윤철이랑 덕이, 선재 그리고 성대, 애훈이 이 정도 도와줬던 것 같은데 그리고 제가 AS를 하기 전에 좀 컨디션 아니 좀 폼이 안 좋아서 재호 형이 진짜 많이 도와줬거든요. 그래서 그것도 고맙고 마지막으로 그 제가 빌드 짜는데 이제 결정적인 사람이 한 명 있었는데 이제 영호가 진짜 빌드 다 짜주고 자기 일처럼 열심히 도와줬거든요.
네. 그러니까
선뜻 옛날에 같은 팀이었다는 이유만으로 진짜 잘 도와줘가지고 자신 있게 게임 했던 것 같아요. 너무 고맙다고 전하고 싶어요.
이렇게 진심을 다해 도와준 동료들만큼이나 또 팬분들도 이번 시즌 황병영 선수가 굉장히 높은 곳에 올라가기를 기원하고 계실 것 같습니다. 그런 기원을 갖고 계신 팬분들께도 인사 전해주시죠.
진짜 아까 인터뷰 때 얘기했던 것처럼 제가 폼이 제일 좋다고 생각을 해요. 제가 지금까지 했던 것 중에. 그래서 더 열심히 준비해서 좋은 경기를 좀 보여드리고 싶어요.
네. 이 자신감으로 이번 시즌 멋진 모습 보여주시길 기다리고 있겠습니다. 다시 한번 진출 축하드립니다.
감사합니다.
ASL 시즌 폴트 24강 기조 경기의 두 번째 진출자 황병영 선수와 함께했습니다.
And so there you have it. Hero winning the group pretty easily, honestly. Pretty one-sided. I almost don't even remember his games. And then Barracks able to take Shuttle down a couple of times, but definitely felt like Shuttle could have won there as well. So pretty highly contested there for second place.
Yeah. Sorry, go ahead.
Oh, sorry. I was just going to say our next group. It's on the screen. I got to say what's on the screen. It's Queen, Miso, Sharp, and Royal. I think that this is a great group.
No Protoss is allowed for Group C. Yeah, this is going to be a fun one, man. I think Miso's going to have a tough time, but Queen, Sharp, Royal, man, these are all very scary players. Queen's got to get out, right?
Yeah, I think so. But upsets do occur, right? Like, Royal and Sharp can both beat Queen, and you know what? Miso can too. ZvZ is a crazy matchup.
Yeah,
so,
for sure.
Anything can happen, but yeah, I think Queen has to be the favorite overall. He's just been such a dominating force in the last, like, five seasons of ASL.
Yeah, we could get a lot of great mirror matchups out of that, but no matter what, also some great ZvTs as well. As we're going to just power through these groups. And again, guys, thank you for your patience. I know that this happens at the start of the season where you guys are ready for these BODs to be out. It takes us a little bit of time to get everything set up, but Artosis and I have scheduled out these next recordings. We're going to be banging these out and getting them out as soon as possible for you guys.
That's right. It's all going to speed up from here. So thank you so much for subscribing to the Patreon at patreon.com/ASL English. Definitely check that out if you have not. And it was a great day of Brood War once again, and I can't wait for Group C.
We'll see you at Group C, guys. We love you. Take care. Till next time. Bye-bye.